Today, Garrett Wolf tries to regain his Heisman swerve in a battle with Temple. It's time for the Huskies to leave it all on the field if their bowl dreams are to become reality. It's homecoming in DeKalb, Illinois, Brigham Field at Husky Stadium as the Temple Owls invade from Philadelphia to battle the Northern Illinois Huskies. Good afternoon, everybody. Alongside former NFL star Tom Waddle, I'm David Kaplan. And Tommy, last week the Huskies ran into a buzzsaw in Western Michigan.
Yeah, they made a ton of mistakes in that ball game. They did not open up any holes for Garrett Wolf up front. And Phil Horvath threw three interceptions in his first 10 passes, so consequently they come away with a loss.
All right, now Garrett Wolf is the nation's leading rusher. He had a tough week last week. It's a big game for him.
Well, give Western Michigan a ton of credit. They did something that Ohio State and five others could not do, and that's contain Garrett Wolf. He had just 25 yards on 18 carries. I don't think he'll stay down. He's too good a football player. Still leads all of college football with 195 rushing yards per game. I think he will bounce back against the Temple defense that has really struggled this year to stop the run. They give up almost 250 yards per game on the ground. You see the numbers. What a start to the season for Garrett. Through six games, he was averaging almost 230 yards per game on the ground. Last week, a bit of a hiccup, but I think, again, he will bounce back against this Temple defense.
All right, when you look at Temple and Coach Al Golden, who you know very well, this is a team that plays more true freshmen than any team in America.
Yeah, I've known Al and his staff for a long time, and it's a group of great football coaches. They knew when they took this program over that it was going to be an uphill battle. They had to break this thing all the way down to build it back up. As you say, there's a ton of young kids playing, 20 true freshmen. It is an uphill battle, but I think athletic director Bill Bradshaw made a tremendous decision in hiring an Al Golden, and I believe that Al's going to turn this thing around sooner rather than later.
All right, we'll have the starting lineups and the opening kickoff coming up. It's the Huskies and the Owls from DeKalb coming up on Comcast Sportsnet.
You know, there are some things families just don't like to share.
They don't want to share this.
Or this.
Or these.
Or this. That's why with U.S. Cellular's family plan, everyone in the family gets their own phone. Plus, they can talk to each other free.
Speaking of which, does anyone want to talk about these?
Oh, those are Dwayne's!
See, you thought you lost them.
U.S. Cellular, we connect with you. Right now, get up to four free phones when you buy one for only $29.95.
Stop on in, we've got what you need. Stop on in, you're on the run.
At Casey's, we don't do thin and skimpy pizzas. Casey's piles them up real heavy. All month, get free cheese breadsticks with the purchase of any large pizza. Come in now and enter to win the Snickers Casey's Super Bowl Celebration Sweepstakes. You and a friend could end up at Super Bowl 41 in Miami.
Stop on in to Casey's General Store.
On December 17th, Range Rover Sport experienced rush hour 200 feet beneath Tokyo. See how at LandRoverUSA.com. Designed for the extraordinary, the Range Rover Sport by Land Rover.
It's official in a positive manner.
This broadcast of Northern Illinois Husky football on Tomcast Sportsnet is brought to you by U.S. Cellular. We connect with you. Fatty's Bar and Grill, the official tailgate home of NIU Athletics. Village Commons Bookstore. For all your Husky clothing and souvenirs, visit vcbs.com. Applebee's. Try Applebee's Car Side to Go. You call it in, we bring it out. Casey's General Stores, the official convenience store of NIU Athletics. Casey's, a convenience store and a whole lot more. Blaine's Farm and Fleet. I found it at Farm and Fleet. The NIU MBA programs. Take the NIU MBA Challenge. The NIU Alumni Association. Stay connected with NIU. And Kishwaukee Hospital. Welcome back in. We are in DeKalb, Illinois. It's Brigham Field at Husky Stadium. David Kaplan and Tom Waddle with you. The Resource Bank. Keys to the game.
Well, the first one's going to be ride your horse, or should it be ride your Husky? Garrett Wolf is that Husky slash horse, despite a rough go last week. Northern needs to give him the football early and often. They got to take care of the ball. Phil Horvath threw three picks in his first 10 passes last week against Western Michigan. That cannot happen. And keep an eye on Tim Brown. No, not the Heisman Trophy winner years ago from Notre Dame, the number 7 tailback from Temple. He's their most dangerous weapon on offense, averaging almost 100 yards per game on the ground.
All right, 24, Chris Page, 22, Travis Shelton, deep. Nendick to kick, Chris Nendick, standout kicker for the Huskies. Homecoming Saturday here in DeKalb. The game is a complete sellout. It was sold out yesterday. Nendick approaches it, and we are underway. It'll go high and deep into the end zone, and Temple says, nope, we'll take a knee, bring it out. They'll start first and 10 at the 20 as Shelton gets the touchback. The Applebee's Temple starters for Coach Al Golden in his first season as he tries to rebuild this program.
Don't you have them memorized? Give them to us.
I want to make sure there weren't any changes. Oh. Brown, Francis, Brown, Holly, Bundy. I got them all for you. Kodak, America's storyteller.
Oh, my goodness.
Temple O-line anchored by Satchel inside. Darren Thal, Dwayvon Battle. Single back set, which you'll also see from the Huskies. They'll hand it off to Brown, and he will pick his way across the 25-yard line. As a helmet goes flying from a Husky defender, Bradley Pruitt in on the tackle.
And you'll see a lot of this today. You want Temple's going to want to run the football, control the clock, shorten this game, and certainly keep Garrett Wolf off the field.
There's the Applebee's NIU defensive starters, led by Kenny West. There's the linebacking core, Keenan Blaylock, McCarthy. There's Rice and Ryder, Upchick, Bradley Pruitt. A second down and 4 situation. And this one, a little bit of trickery will go absolutely nowhere for the Owls. We do have a flag on the play. Shelton the carrier, English the man that blew it up.
There is a flag on the play.
Huskies say the penalty is on Temple. What'd you see, Tom Waddle?
I think we got a clip or a block below the waist. What I saw was Corey Hansen actually destroy that play.
Chop block on the offense, number 83. The penalty is declined. Result of the play is third down.
And it really made no sense. The block was made well away from where the play was headed.
And the block was down the field.
Yeah, Al Golden a little disappointed early on here. He's seen his team commit a ton of turnovers and a ton of penalties this year. As we said, 20 true freshmen playing today. There are going to be some mistakes, but certainly on the road, you cannot put yourself in third long all afternoon.
Yeah, Adam DeMichael, the quarterback, a sophomore out of McKees Rocks, Pennsylvania. Getting the nod today over Vaughn Charlton. He's pressured, he throws, and he's got his man. A big time throw with heat coming, Tom.
DeMichael does a nice job standing in the pocket.
Finds Travis Shelton.
Very patient as well. He allowed his receiver to get into his cut. And you'll see the blitz coming up the middle. Tim McCarthy trying to put on the pressure on Adam. DeMichael steps up and makes a tremendous throw.
Actually, that was Bruce Francis who made the catch as he looked downfield. He was looking. We've got one guy cramping up a bit. That was Francis. First down, move the sticks for Temple. A real big-time throw. And this one will be blown dead. I think a false start penalty.
And Devin Tyler is going to be called for rocking back in his stance. Left tackle for Temple.
Before the play, false start. Number 73 on the offense. That's a five-yard penalty. Still first down.
You'll see, top right of your screen, you'll see Devin Tyler also small of a hitch, but again, Al Golden's watched his team. Two penalties in this first drive. The numbers don't look great for Coach Golden right now, but again, we talked about it in the open. This is an opportunity for him to build this program from the floor up, and those numbers are going to get better gradually over time.
Brown, the tail of the tandem. DeMichael barking out signals now, says, I need a timeout.
I'm not sure they got it.
Did he get it? I don't know if they'll give it to him.
May have a delay of game.
There's no penalty on the play prior to the 25 second clock. Expiring. Timeout. Offense.
All right, we're going to take a timeout. DeMichael gets the timeout. Temple's on the attack, first and 15. When we come back at the 36 on Comcast SportsNet.
Advance your career with an MBA from Northern Illinois University.
I was able to balance my MBA with my professional life as well as my personal life. And best of all, NIU's MBA program is AACSB accredited and affordable.
I was impressed with the knowledge and experience of the professors, and the program provided me with a well-rounded business education. The affordability and convenient locations made my decision easy, and it made my MBA a reality.
Designed for the working professional, the MBA program at Northern Illinois University. Jumpstart your career today.
NIU fans, when you enter the Village Commons bookstore, you're entering Husky territory. VCB is the official site for NIU athletics, featuring the new NIU logo on a wide range of hats, t-shirts, shorts, sweats, and NIU logo gifts and accessories. Whether you're a student, graduate, or a fan of NIU athletics, the Village Commons bookstore is your Husky headquarters. Visit us in DeKalb or call us toll-free 800-700-4868 or on the web at www.vcbs.com.
The broadcast rights for this event have been granted to Comcast SportsNet by Northern Illinois University. Any reproduction or rebroadcast without the express written consent of Comcast SportsNet and NIU is strictly prohibited. First and 15 at their own 36. They'll hand it to Brown, and he will get nothing. May have fallen forward for a yard. Maybe. Kenny West, the man who got up there and laid the lumber on him.
Ken West, he's got tremendous speed on the edge, whether he's rushing the passer or he's collapsing and hunting down a tailback.
Second and 15. They call it absolutely no game. DeMichael with a single back set. Drops, looks, throws, finds his man, and he'll be close but short of a first down. Probably they'll spot it right around the 49-yard line. It'll probably come up with a third and two. Mike Holly makes the catch on the play.
Well, you could see why Coach Al Golden decided to go with DeMichael today. Vaughn Charlton had started the last couple of games, but DeMichael, as a redshirt sophomore, a little bit more experienced, just a little sit-down route. Mike Holly finds a seam and gets his team within a couple of yards of a first down, but DeMichael so far showing tremendous poise at the quarterback position.
Third and a short three for the Temple Owls of Coach Al Golden. They'll throw the football, and he finds his man. He moves the chains again with a good throw, but we do have Yellow Laundry.
I believe this
Steve
Mineri
made the catch. And it is a hold on the Temple Owls.
Yeah, you just can't have these kinds of mistakes.
Second penalty on Temple today.
Actually, the third in this drive.
Is it the third?
I believe so.
Because you had the one picked up on the delay game.
You want to argue this early? It's going to be a long day. We got 3 hours to talk.
Foul is penalized 10 yards from the previous spot. Repeat third down.
Al Golden not happy at all. You've known him a long time.
I have. Played against Al when he was at Penn State. He was a tight end at Penn State.
There's our guy, Joe Novak.
I was at Boston College.
Now, one second, Tommy. As you look at that record, 58-63, people at home go, 58-63. Don't forget, when he took the job, they went at a 23-game losing streak as he tried to rebuild a program that was completely buried, and he's done just that with a tremendous run here in DeKalb.
Coach Novak looking for his seventh straight winning season here in DeKalb.
Empty backfield for DeMichael. He's pressured, throws, finds his man, and it's going to be very close. We'll see where they spot this. Another good throw.
Another fine catch by Mike Holly as well.
Corey Hansen made the tackle, but we'll see if this is enough to move the sticks.
And the Huskies come after DeMichael. He just steps up again, a little hot route. Mike Holly gets inside of Corey Hansen. Looks like he may be just a touch short, but he climbs the ladder, makes a great catch. I was talking to Coach Golden on the field before the game. He says, listen, we've got a lot of young kids, but we've got a lot of talented players. Holly's actually a senior.
Yeah, I'm going to say he's about a foot short, Tommy.
They feel very good about the athletic ability of their young team.
It's going to be just short, less than a foot.
Al's not real excited about the spot.
It's probably going to be right close to 10 to 12 inches. What do you do?
Well, you're 0-7. You're on the road. You go for it. You line up. You ask your offensive lineman to give your running back a good 3 or 4 feet. You get the first down and you continue the drive. These are the types of character building moments that can bring a team together, especially one that has experienced so much losing over the course of the first 7 weeks of the season.
The bell tolls in DeKalb for the NIU offense. They try and keep their MAC West title hopes alive. As Tommy said, Temple 0-7, rebuilding under a fine young coach. Joe Novak asks his defense to make a play. Real tight formation for Temple. I don't know if he got it.
They're going to give it to him with the spot. If you see the official on the far side of the field, it depends on where he drops the football. But it looks from here like he may have gotten it by the nose of the ball. Ball's got across the 49-yard line into maybe the 48-and-a-half. You see, he's got a seam, and DeMichael just puts his head down. If he'd have gone a little more to his left, he may have had it easily.
As I look through the binoculars, I'm going to agree with you. I think he got it.
I think it's a good spot.
He got it by the nose of the football.
I think his forward progress got him at least there. And then the Huskies jammed it up and pushed him back. But again, Al Golden's got to be very happy about this drive right now. They have made several first downs despite three penalties.
Tommy, you also, from an Al Golden perspective, you've kept Garrett Wolf off the field.
That's exactly right. That's your best defense, is to keep him on the sidelines.
Single back set, DeMichael under center on a first and 10. He'll throw a wide receiver screen, and that's going to be a productive play out to the 40-yard line of Northern Illinois. Second down and about one coming up.
Just a little bubble screen. Get the ball outside to your athletes and let them make a play. Nick Santa Cruz.
I'll tell you what, though.
Good yardage on first down. I think this Husky defense is back on their heels right now. They had a very disappointing loss last week to Western Michigan. You look at the numbers, Temple comes in at 0-7 and really hasn't done anything well on either side of the ball. And Temple's taking it to him right now.
Real good blocking by Mike Holly, the wide receiver, number 3. And off to Tim Brown, and Tim Brown will pick up enough for another Temple Owl first down. Keenan Blaylock, number 33, motored over from his linebacker spot to make the stop.
You look at the numbers for Tim Brown, averaging more than 4.5 yards per carry. Gives them some senior leadership out there. And you see Keenan Blaylock, who leads the Huskies in tackles so far this year. Be a very good matchup at the line of scrimmage. The Huskies have had a number of injuries on their defensive line, and that Temple offensive line very young and inexperienced.
Tim Brown, the single back set. Adam DeMichael, the quarterback, a sophomore. DeMichael gonna throw, it's incomplete. Incomplete off the hands of Marcus Brown, the big tight end, just a freshman out of Upper Marlboro, Maryland, 6'4 and 255. Let's go down to the sideline. The third member of our crew is Mark Scafidi. Mark.
All right, thanks, guys. We have an injury update for Bruce Francis, who was injured earlier on this drive. He's got a left hamstring injury. There was ice on it earlier. They just took it off, and he's trying to walk it off. His return is questionable at this point. Dave?
All right, thank you, Mark. Mark will be checking in with us all day from both sidelines. Second and 10 at the 38. Pressure on DeMichael, and he's going down in a heap. Back in Temple territory at the 49, Larry English, number 51, the man there.
Now he and Ken West, a lot of pressure on DeMichael. I'll give DeMichael credit for taking care of the football, not putting it on the carpet. Just a great speed rush from both sides. Kenny West is the first one to put a hand on DeMichael, and then Larry English steps in and finishes him off. But again,
nearly got the mask.
DeMichael does a nice job taking care of the football.
Third and 22 for Temple. Ball is spotted right at midfield.
See Danny Dornbus expecting more big plays out of his Husky defense today.
DeMichael looking, throws, and it is incomplete, nearly picked off by Tim McCarthy, number 53, the middle linebacker, read it and nearly grabbed it. Temple's going to punt the football. Fourth and 22 at midfield. As you look, Tom, he had a good shot at this one.
Yeah, Tim McCarthy does a great job getting a hand on it. Even if that ball is caught by Santa Cruz, that's not going to be a first down. There aren't too many plays in your playbook designed for third and 22. But as you said earlier, Al Golden, yeah, the drive stalls, but the Owls eat up 7 minutes of the clock and keep Garrett Wolf off the field.
High snap. Good catch, gets it away. Marcus Perez will fair catch it at the 18-yard line. We'll take a timeout. Huskies, Garrett Wolf coming up when we come back.
My wife works hard, the kids are 10, 6, and 3. Our life together gets a little crazy. So I called Applebee's like I've done before. They brought our favorite foods out to my car door.
With Applebee's Carside to Go, you call it in, we bring it out.
Now my wife runs to meet me just as fast as she can, cause there's something women like about a pickup man.
Applebee's Carside to Go. It's not fast food, it's Applebee's.
Looking for a new job or career change? Visit us online at metrochicagojobs.com or chicagodiversity.com and check out new job opportunities from the area's top employers. Premier companies hiring right now include AC Nielsen, ADT Security Services, CBA Tire, Midwest Generation, Northwestern Memorial Hospital, OfficeMax, Guarantee Bank, and Chase Bank. Visit us online at metrochicagojobs.com or chicagodiversity.com and find your new job today.
Golfers, need help with your putt, chip, or drive? Then grab your remote and go to the Golf Channel On Demand Workshop. You'll find great tips from the experts at the Golf Channel, guaranteed to improve your handicap. One-on-one golf lessons anytime you want, only on demand from Comcast. To access, from your on-demand menu, select Searchlight, Your Life, then Golf Workshop.
We offer 4,000 flights to 250 cities in 40 countries around the world every day. We know why you fly. We're American Airlines.
All right, there you look at number 62, the All-American Doug Freak, and the man behind him, number one, Garrett Wolf. You look at the Husky rushing leaders, Tommy. He's got a pretty good shot at becoming number one.
Yeah, I think not. I'm not going to say it's going to happen today, but certainly in the next couple of weeks, he will pass Michael Turner as the all-time leading rusher for the Huskies. Michael Turner, by the way, having an outstanding career early on with the San Diego Chargers.
All right. Four wide receivers, single back set. Horvath to throw, wide receiver screen. Going to be a gain of about seven. Matt Simon makes the catch. And the Huskies in business. Second, and we'll call it three.
Well, everybody in the stands knows that Garrett Wolf's going to get the ball 30, 35 times today, so why not show the Owls that we can also throw it? Good positive play on first down. Same play that the Temple group ran in their drive, just a little wide receiver screen. Ball in the hands of your athletes and let them make plays. They never ran that play to me at any level. That surprise you?
Not even at the little kids.
No.
Horvath going up top, finds his man Carter. First down into Temple territory. Jarrett Carter, number 14, makes the catch.
Well, if not Carter, he also had Matt Simon running down the middle of the field as well. Starts with the protection. Phil Horvath has all day to throw it. Just a dart to Carter. Gets it over top of the Temple defender, Ryan Herding.
Well, I think the Temple defense is saying, well, where's Garrett? Where's number one? That's the guy we watched tape on.
They stack 7, 8, 9 in the box, and you threaten or you force teams to beat you through the air. And right now, the Huskies are trying to do that.
Marcus Perez makes a catch and ducks out of bounds at the 43. Let's look at the Applebee's, Northern Illinois. Offensive starters. There he is, number one, Garrett Wolf, leads the country in rushing. Britt Davis, the Z-man, is number seven. Tight end Brandon Davis. And you look at that big O-line led by Doug Free, the freak who will be probably a first-round NFL pick.
Making his 43rd consecutive start. Hasn't missed a game here.
Second and six. Horvath throwing again. Looking, tosses it out of bounds. Wise decision, nobody open.
Well, Phil Horvath, a little better start than last week. You see his season numbers. Not as effective this year as he was last year prior to the injury. Joe Novak likes his quarterbacks to have a little better touchdown to interception ratio than 7-6. But as I said off the top of the broadcast, Horvath threw three picks in the first 10 tosses last week against Western Michigan. They just never got anything going on the ground or through the air.
Third and six. And with Garrett Wolf, you usually think it's a passing down, but you never know. Horvath steps up, fires, got his man. And that's going to be a first down for Matt Simon, number 85. And he takes it to the 21-yard line. See where they spot this one. Maybe a little bit short of that.
Horvath
call it
again.
The 24.
Does a nice job stepping up, and someone blows an assignment, leaves Matt Simon all by himself. Again, a communication breakdown. You have freshmen and sophomores in that Temple secondary.
I guarantee you Garrett Wolf touches it here. Guarantee it. Garrett Wolf has it. Garrett Wolf will be stacked up at the line of scrimmage. Philip Simpson, number 94, 6'2", 275, a sophomore from Miami, Florida, made the tackle. You see they run a 3-4 alignment. There's their three men. There's their linebackers, Mabane and Herding inside there. And there's their D-backs, led by Richard Shepard and Chris Page, the safeties.
Second and 10
at the 24-yard line. Little play action, dumps it off, finds a tight end, picks up about five. Brandon Davis makes the catch.
Yeah, Brandon Davis being asked to do a whole lot more these days with Jake Nordine out with a broken leg. Just a simple play action fake. And when you run the football as effectively as the Huskies, these types of passes are going to be open. Davis takes a shot on his knee.
Third and five, they will call it. Third and five. Horvath barking out signals.
His wide receivers are going to be in man-to-man coverage all day with these Temple defensive backs.
Horvath looking, throws, and cannot find Marcus Perez. He's asking for a flag, Horvath, saying my guy was interfered with. But it's going to be a no-go, and Nendick will come on and attempt a field goal.
Now, I think if Horvath's a little more patient and lets Perez get out of his break. Good coverage back there by George Coleman. And Horvath rushes the pass a little bit, just outside the outstretched hands of Marcus Perez.
36 yards will be the field goal attempt for Chris Nendick. Horvath puts it down, and it is perfect. 3-0 Huskies. We're taking a timeout. Huskies on top, 4:57 left in the first in DeKalb.
For over 50 years, Blaine's Farm and Fleet has been supplying families with all kinds of quality goods at low prices. And for those big bags of supplies you need for everyday life, no other store offers more. At Farm and Fleet, you'll find water softener salt, a big selection of food for your pets, lots of food for the birds, and their extensive line of agricultural feeds and supplements. You'll appreciate their tradition of convenience, quality, and value. For big bags and more, Blaine's Farm and Fleet is your store.
Maybe you want a sedan designed for the driver. Or one that's also beautiful on the inside. Or one that can outrun the price of gas. There's a way to have all three. Introducing the 2007 Saturn Aura midsize sedan. Lease a new 2007 Saturn Aura XE for around $257 a month. Residency restrictions apply. Call for lease details.
Welcome back, a homecoming Saturday. It is completely sold out here at Brigham Field at Husky Stadium. The Husky scoring drive, NIU Alumni Association brings that to you. 9 plays, 62 yards, took 257. Nendick, a 36-yard field goal.
And surprisingly, 8 passes and 1 run.
1 run for no yards.
That's right. As I said, you know, Temple's going to come out here, as all defenses do, when they game plan for Northern Illinois and Garrett Wolf. They're going to stack the line of scrimmage, trying to shut down the run and force you to beat them through the air. And this first drive, that's exactly what Joe Novak's guys try to do.
Another deep, deep kick, and this one will go through the back of the end zone. No return again, and Temple starts. First and 10 at their own 20. Boy, Nendick's got a strong leg, doesn't he?
Especially when the wind is aiding him. But yes, he does.
Yeah, but you look at the goalpost, Tom, you really don't see a ton of wind. You look.
Well, it'd take a lot of wind to blow the goalpost. Or are you talking the flags on top of the goalpost?
There, smart guy.
Sorry. By the way, you saw the homecoming numbers. How about the home field advantage the Huskies have enjoyed recently? 17-3 their last 20 games here in Brigham Field.
DeMichael gonna hand off to Tim Brown. Tim Brown turned back after a gain of 1. A pack of red shirts led by Zach Holycross made the tackle.
You'll see again, good penetration from the front four for Northern. Zach Holycross just sheds his block. Wraps up Tim Brown for a short gain. This defensive line, I talked about it earlier for the Huskies, just a number of injuries they've suffered through this year.
Second and call it 9. Hand off to Tim Brown, strung out. Tim Brown will be dragged down for no gain. Tim McCarthy from his middle linebacker spot shot through and made the tackle.
Once again, a solid defensive effort from the Huskies. The line of scrimmage, they're standing up, all the white jerseys, and right there, Tim McCarthy just does a great job shedding the block again. Huskies doing a nice job slowing down the Temple run today.
Third and 9. Now, DeMichael looked good the first drive in situations just like this. Huskies, I'm sure, will look to bring some pressure. DeMichael looking, looking, and he is going to go down. Second sack of the day.
Second one from Larry English as well.
I think he just got a hand on his leg.
He grabbed a shoestring, I think. DeMichael was shuffling his feet to step up in the pocket. You'll see the pressure come from the top of your screen. Larry English just drives Devin Taylor back into DeMichael.
I thought it was Freddie Kibu, the turf elf, that got him first. Danny Murphy will punt his second of the day. Marcus Perez will stand with his heels at his own 40-yard line. Snap, rush on, he gets it away. It's gonna bounce, and it will roll down. And keep rolling, a good tempo roll to the 38-yard line. And that's where Northern Illinois will go on the attack. First and 10, leading 3-0.
You know, special teams is an area where you can really help your team, especially when you're struggling in other facets of the game. When your offense is only averaging 7 points and 200 total yards per game, field position is a huge issue. And I'm sure Coach Al Golden has talked to his team, listen, we're going to struggle at times on offense and defense, but we have to be very sound on special teams and not put either side, offense or defense, into a bind.
Horvath going to sprint out, throw, find Marcus Perez. He'll turn it upfield. Gets belted, and a gang of white shirts dragging down at the 47-yard line.
I love to see that out of a young man. Now, I don't like to see him be gang-tackled and knocked silly, but that tells me that young man, Marcus Perez, likes the game of football. He could have easily stepped out of bounds. He decided to step back into the boundary, pick up a few more yards, and in the process,
Now take a look at Phillip Simpson. Last week in the NFL, Troy Polamalu was tackled by hair like that. I thought that was a penalty. You can grab the hair. Did you know that?
I did not know that.
I was not aware of that. So if he picks up a fumble, I guess they've got something else to latch on to.
Free game.
Garrett Wolf into the secondary, and Garrett Wolf rips off his best run of the day. Second, Gary Richard Shepard made the tackle, but move the chains for the Huskies.
Let me tell you what, keep an eye on Richard Shepard, because right about now he's on Fantasy Island all by himself. And that's one heck of an open field tackle against maybe the best running back in the nation right now. This is a huge hole for Garrett Wolf to run through, but you're a man on an island when you're Richard Shepard right there. And a very nice open field tackle. Little surprised to see that is only the second carry of the day for Garrett Wolf. I'm sure it won't be his last.
No, I would bet not. They'll give it to Wolf again, and he turns it upfield. Garrett Wolf dragging tacklers inside the 25-yard line. Ryan Herding made the tackle.
And now Richard Shepard is batting 500 against Garrett Wolf, because as we saw there, he ran right by him. You look at the numbers, he averages 195 yards per game. That's tops in the NCAA. So is his all-purpose numbers at 223, and so are his scoring numbers of 12.3.
How about the number that he's out rushing by himself, 105 Division I teams?
Pretty impressive.
Garrett Wolf will rip off a 5-yard chunk right here. Chris Page makes the tackle, number 24, a senior D-back out of Aurora, Colorado. So you pass for a while, then you hit him with the real stuff.
Well, you try to get that extra defender out of the tackle box, make them honor the pass, and then you hit him with a guy who averages a buck 95 a game.
He has more yards now than he had all of last week when the running game just couldn't get untracked. Horvath fakes, rolling, steps, throws back in the end zone, touchdown! Northern Illinois, give him six. Matt Simon makes the grab.
He was standing all alone by himself for quite some time. You can tell he was getting nervous back there, getting the ball before someone in a white jersey gets near him. Temple's having a problem with the left side of their pass defense right now. And again, we talked about it. When you run the football effectively, play action pass is going to work. And the Temple defender just turns him loose, steps up to try to cover the drag. Britt Davis came across on shallow route. Matt Simon left all alone in the end zone.
Nendick nails the extra point, and the Huskies a 10-0 lead. Late stages, quarter one. Tommy, real nice job to set his feet here and then sip it in.
As you could see, Matt Simon jumping up and down, waiting for the ball. But Evan Cooper Jr. decided to bite on the drag route and left Matt Simon all by himself.
He was like, hey, don't miss me back here.
And when you're standing alone back there, that is at times the toughest catch in the world to make. No one around you, the ball coming at you, and you know you drop it, it's not going to be pleasant.
Right. All
film
eyes
session
in the
tomorrow.
Stadium are That's all right. on you, baby.
That's important for this Northern Illinois offense to get on track. They had a very difficult go of it last week at Western Michigan. We've talked about it a number of times already. They could not run the football. The offensive line had a dreadful afternoon. Garrett Wolf never got on track. And Phil Horvath struggled all day long. They have bounced back nicely this afternoon.
Shelton and Page, the deep men again. Will they get a chance to return one? Another one about 5 yards deep. He's coming up. Hits the seam, will be knocked down around the 21-yard line. Spencer Williamson makes the tackle of Travis Shelton. Let's go back down to the sidelines. Our man Mark Scafidi. Mark.
Thanks, Dave. And I talked to Phil Horvath this week at practice, and he put all the blame for last week's loss on himself. He wasn't going to spread the blame around anyone. He simply said, we got outplayed. I need to make plays this week for us to get a better chance to win. Dave?
Well,
I hate to say it, but he's right.
He's right.
He's right.
Quarterback taking the responsibility for the offense. We are taking a timeout as we've completed one quarter of play on homecoming Saturday in DeKalb. 10-0 Huskies on a Matt Simon from Phil.
Team up with the Huskies. Join the Husky Athletic Scholarship Fund today, where your financial support assists in providing a world-class academic and athletic experience for 488 student-athletes.
54 Crescita Academic All-Americans.
Highest department GPA in the history of NIU athletics.
MacWest champions in football and men's basketball.
We can't reach our goals without the help of the Husky Athletic Scholarship Fund members.
Call 815-753-1923 for information on joining the HASF.
Ask a few of your friends what they thought after having LASIK eye surgery at the Hauser Ross Eye Institute.
Yeah.
And you might hear something like this.
Yeah, it's one of those things that until afterward, I don't know how I got along without it.
You know, my biggest question for my doctor at Hauser Ross is why did I wait so long to do this?
Find out why so many people have trusted the Hauser Ross Eye Institute for LASIK eye surgery. Call 1-800-CHECKUP today.
This is the 2007 Ford 500 Chrome Edition with 18-inch chrome-clad wheels and chrome mesh grille. It's the safest four-door sedan in its class with the comfort of the largest interior in its class and up to 580 miles on one tank of gas. Get a 2007 Ford 500 Chrome Edition with leather and air for just $22,633 or choose 0% financing. The 2007 Chrome Edition 500.
Come on, baby, let's go.
The band is playing, the place is packed, everybody wearing red. David Kaplan, Tom Wattlemark, Scafidi with you in DeKalb, Illinois.
I have brown on.
You do, I have black
on. All my red stuff was at the dry cleaners. You see the scoring drive, 5 plays, 62 yards, capped by a 20-yard touchdown pass. Phil Horvath to Matt Simon, and again, surprise. They've thrown it 10 times to just 4 runs in the first 2 drives for the Huskies.
And Temple trying to run the football. Keenan Blaylock was the man in there to knock Tim Brown, number 7, to the turf. Tim Brown, 5'8", 190, a bowling ball. 2nd and 9.
Sure he would appreciate that description.
Well, I mean that in a most endearing way. He's small, but he's tough.
Well, I envision a bowling ball as round,
just rolls over you, buddy. Those of us built like bowling balls have to use that as
something
an endurance.
Something tells me you have a little bit more body fat than Tim Brown.
Just a bit. DeMichael looking. Pressure. Larry English chasing him, and he got him. Football loose. And the Huskies pick it up. But I believe they're going to call it down. I believe they will say.
No, and they're going to give this ball to Northern. A lot happened in that particular play. It's a coverage sack to begin with. The Northern secondary has the Temple wide receivers blanketed. And then once again, Larry English with his third sack of the day. DeMichael's got to throw that football in the stands. Did a nice job not panicking, but at the very end, instead of taking that hit and accepting the turnover, you have to throw that football in the stands.
And actually, Craig Rush picked it up. He fumbled it.
What are you supposed to do as a defensive lineman when the ball's on the ground?
Adriel Hansborough.
Dive on it like it's a sandwich.
Garrett Wolf around the right side. Garrett Wolf will be dragged down at the 11-yard line. Actually, inside the 10-yard line, so he will have picked up maybe a yard there. Richard Sheppard, your guy, made the tackle.
Yeah, you see Garrett bounce it to the outside, and once again, Richard Sheppard, he's now batting 666 against Garrett Wolf.
Gain of 2 yards.
Gain of 2 on the play.
Second down and goal from the 6.
In baseball, why do they give you 3 digits? If you're batting 255, why wouldn't they just say you're batting 26? Well, you'd round up, so you'd say 26%. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
So I just said that Richard Sheppard was batting 666.
Garrett Wolf breaking tackles, drags tacklers to the 2-yard line. Again, Richard Sheppard there.
I've said it every week I've been here in DeKalb watching Garrett Wolf play. I don't understand how a man who's 5'7" and 177 pounds has this much explosive power in his body. His legs never stop, and you very rarely ever see anybody knock him backwards. It's an excellent tackle by Richard Sheppard. But Garrett Wolf always has that forward lean and always has that drive that pushes him an extra yard or two.
Third and 2 as Horvath changes the play. He's going to throw and find no. It's going to be dropped.
Marcus Lewis.
Marcus Lewis, number 89, a freshman out of Warren High School in Gurnee.
Take the points, kick it.
Crowd yelling, go for it. Joe Novak says, no, I'll take the field goal and go up 13.
Now you watch this play and you're going to say, well, Phil Horvath throws this ball behind Marcus Lewis. But Phil Horvath throws that ball right where he was supposed to. Marcus Lewis, a freshman's got to learn to throttle it down. That ball's got to be thrown on his back shoulder because he's running into 2 Temple defenders.
Chip shot 19, and I think Temple jumped. Did they jump or are we going to get a false start?
You're going to get a false start. I believe John Brost.
Before the play, false start. On
you got it.
Number 65. 5-yard penalty.
Actually,
still fourth down.
Jason jumps. You get his last name, I'll get
Jason
his first.
Jason Onibuagu.
Thank you.
Mendick. One of the best to ever kick for Northern Illinois. Field goal up. Field goal good. Huskies 13, Owls nothing. They'll get the ball back after this timeout on Comcast SportsNet.
Husky fans, Fatty's Pub and Grill in DeKalb is your official pre- and post-game NIU football headquarters. Whether you're catching a game on our big screens or having some of our famous grilled food out in our beer garden, Fatty's is the place to be. Join us on October 21st for Fatty's Centennial Homecoming Outdoor Tent Party with Trippin' Billy's playing live on stage after the game. For more information, log on to fattyspub.com. It's all at Fatty's Pub and Grill, located directly south of Husky Stadium on Route 38 in DeKalb.
At Jewel, it's the fresh way we trim, slice, serve, the fresh way we grind, prepare, fish. It's offering the freshest variety, the best poultry, beef, pork, seafood that's oh so fresh. and help from our experts in store. Top quality, great service, all fresh to your family from Jewel.
Everybody having a good time at Husky Stadium.
Somebody's crying.
It's tears of joy, buddy.
Oh my gosh.
Her Huskies are up 13. The NIU Alumni Association Huskies scoring drive.
Yeah, that can't,
four plays, 2 yards.
That can't make Coach Joe Novak happy. You get a turnover in Temple territory, and you get 3 instead of 7. Got to turn those opportunities into touchdowns.
Nendick into the wind this time, and another deep kick will be down in the end zone. So he doesn't get aided by the wind
this
time.
He's driving that football today, just like I said a few minutes ago. He is pounding it.
I'll bet. Larry English, an absolute beast.
What have we played so far? We've played, 18 minutes? Larry English has already got 3 sacks. He's been all over Adam DeMichael so far this afternoon. And this is a Husky defense that has lacked the big play all year long. Their first 7 games, they only registered 12 sacks. Larry English has got 3 of his own already today. And a caused fumble.
Tim Brown, the tail of the tandem. Adam DeMichael will hand it to Brown. Football loose, Huskies have got it.
Guess who?
Larry English. I wonder, Adriel Hansbrough is the man who stripped it. Larry English recovered it. Somebody's on his way to a MAC Defensive Player of the Week performance.
Somebody ought to be down to his local Citgo to buy himself a lottery ticket right now as well.
Watch Hansbrough.
Great hit by Hansbrough. And this is just
a hustle play.
Larry, it's your day, baby.
Just a hustle play from behind.
Absolutely. Not that Larry hasn't earned it. His 3 sacks were all effort. And this one, as you say, is all about getting downfield and making a play.
Horvath looking, fires, and incomplete. Looking for Marcus Perez.
Marcus Perez, the intended receiver.
George Coleman there in coverage, but Horvath had to deal with some hand slapping inside. Your guy, Al Golden, you guys have been friends for a long time.
We have a number of
mutual acquaintances.
Mutual friends, yes. In the football world. As I said, Al was a great tight end at Penn State, played on several bowl teams.
Garrett Wolf trying to turn, cuts it back, and will run into a wall of white.
That's just good defense right there for Temple.
They're literally all 11 defenders and Garrett Wolf at the 40-yard line. Walter Mabane, an inside linebacker from L.A., a 6-foot, 225-pound senior, led the charge for the Temple Owls.
I said it earlier, they've got some talented football players. They're just learning a new system, learning how to play next to one another, learning how to play as a team versus as individuals.
It's a 3rd and 12 now after a loss of a couple. Horvath looking, throwing, and it's incomplete. Wow. Pretty good coverage. George Coleman covering Matt Simon.
It's like there was some contact possibly made a little bit early. Actually, Richard Shepard, Horvath stepping up in the pocket, looking for Simon again, and wow. My athletic history tells me that anytime it's that close, the receiver's got to get the benefit of the doubt. Right?
Yeah, that was Richard Shepard.
And again, Joe Novak cannot be happy. His defense has created turnovers, and his offense has basically wasted the opportunities.
The field goal is no good.
2 turnovers have now turned into just 3 points. And you can see on the Temple sideline, they're jumping around, and as you see on the Husky sideline, some dejected players milling around over there. You're at home. This is homecoming. You do not want to let this Temple team hang around.
and give them hope if you're the Huskies.
Nemec not happy, missing from 50 yards. Temple has turned it over the last two times they've had it. DeMichael gonna throw on first down. He's hit and down he goes again. Larry English, his fourth sack of the day.
Well, he is just, he is driving the offensive tackle, Devin Tyler, just off the ball. Devin Tyler, a redshirt freshman, 6'7", but only 260 pounds. He's a little light.
Tell you what, DeMichael did a good job not to fumble.
He did, but Larry English, he's not even trying to use his quickness now. Larry English is just bull rushing Devin Tyler at this point. And he can smell blood.
Second and 14. Gonna run the football this time. And that one, Tim McCarthy and Dustin Utchick in there to make the tackle. I think Utchick's the guy that really got him wrapped up. McCarthy helped clean it up. Northern Illinois' last two offensive possessions, Tom, 8 plays, 0 yards.
I think the next time they come onto the field, they're really going to concentrate on running the football and getting back to what they do best.
Third and 11 for Adam DeMichael, sophomore quarterback for Coach Al Golden and the Temple Owls. DeMichael looking, looking, going down again. Keenan Blaylock will get his first sack of the day, and Temple will have to punt the football away. There comes Blaylock.
It's just an all-out blitz. Blaylock shooting the gap. Six sacks already.
Eric Pittman, the other man there. They'll each get a half.
Got 5 sacks actually on the day so far.
Danny Murphy, number 45, will be punting this football away. No rush. Marcus Perez at his 30. Marcus Perez. Oh, what a block! Wow! Melvin Rice absolutely obliterated a tackler. Jarrett Dunston is going to want to know what truck just hit him. Huskies up 13. They've got the football.
The verdict is in. The College of Law at Northern Illinois University is one of the nation's most respected law schools. At NIU Law, top students are part of a tight-knit, dynamic, and diverse learning community. Small classes give them unmatched access to some of the best legal scholars in the country, and state-of-the-art technology prepares them for today's courtrooms. Many NIU Law students even get hands-on legal practice before they graduate. That's why so many successful lawyers and judges hold degrees from the NIU College of Law. NIU Law. Discover the difference.
Hey Husky fans, shop online for all the latest Husky merchandise at naubookstore.niu.edu. We carry the best brands, gear, JanSport, Russell, Vantage, Zephyr, and more. Shop any of our three locations, the Home Student Center, the Convocation Center, and our newest location at the Farsima Alumni and Visitor Center. Open 3 hours before game time for every home game. For the best Husky gear selection and prices, stop by today or shop online at niubookstore.niu.edu. That's niubookstore.niu.edu.
No credit, bad credit, short time on the job, bankruptcy. You've heard it all before. We've created a new concept in car buying. The old way of shopping for cars was where you go from dealer to dealer, hoping that one of them will get you financed, wondering what your payment will be, and what kind of car you're going to end up with. The Car Academy does just that. We have relationships with over 30 national lenders, most of whom specialize in Tier 2, less than perfect credit.
Big crowd here in DeKalb. Later tonight, don't miss the excitement of Big 12 football on Comcast SportsNet. Colorado looks to turn their season around with a big upset, a huge upset, when they head to Norman to battle the Sooners of Oklahoma. Colorado, Oklahoma tonight at 6 right here on Comcast SportsNet.
Oklahoma without Adrian Peterson for the rest of the year. Broken collarbone.
Garrett Wolf. Dragged down by Alex Joseph. That is Hollis Thomas, who plays for the New Orleans Saints. Had a 10-year run with the Philadelphia Eagles, and then was picked up by New Orleans last spring.
By the way, who told you the New Orleans Saints at the beginning of this season were going to be the most improved football team in the National Football League?
Our spotter, Hollywood Todd Irwin.
Who? Who?
You.
Thank you.
Phil Horvath looking, throws, got his man, Matt Simon.
So far, 13 passes, 8 runs today.
Not what you normally see
out
of the Huskies.
Not what you normally see. Matt Simon is playing a large role today. Had a touchdown catch earlier. Big 15-yard grab there as well.
Garrett Wolf, as always, single back set for the Northern Illinois Huskies. Phil Horvath barks out signals, hands to Wolf. Takes it into the teeth of the defense. It'll be close to a first down. Very close. See on the spot.
Not a lot of space for Garrett to run. They're going to give him the first down.
Move the chains.
Offensive line. Well, actually,
he did a nice job to break the tackle of Ryan Gore.
Ryan Gore just fell into the hole. Kind of disrupted the play.
Garrett was able to shed him.
But for the most part, this Temple defense has done a very nice job slowing Garrett Wolf down today.
Horvath will give to Garrett Wolf, and he is blown up. Absolutely belted by John Haley.
John Haley with
another negative play. There's been a bunch of negative plays,
there,
Tom.
Have. And normally the left side of that offensive line with Doug Free and Chris Acevedo
will
normally create some running room, but right now Temple's getting great penetration. They're standing up the Northern offensive line.
Garrett Wolf, 10 carries so far, just 30 yards. Horvath looking. Fires. Jarrett Carter makes the catch, fights his way, be just short of the 50-yard line or right at it. It'll be a third down and about 5.
Well, they're not effectively running the football, so they're going to stick with the passing game again. Phil Horvath has all day to throw it. Jarrett Carter, a simple curl route. Have to be impressed with the enthusiasm shown by this Temple defense.
Even getting down 13, they've come out and really taken a challenge to stopping the NIU offense, especially Garrett Wolf.
Flying around the ball.
Horvath fires. Britt Davis has it, stretches, and got the first down.
That's just
move
a
the chain.
Great individual effort by Britt Davis. Phil Horvath once again showing some poise in the pocket. He gets pressured. See, they just clear it out on the left side. Britt Davis comes dragging across. Just a great individual effort getting past the first down marker.
Garrett Wolf in his past 5.5 quarters, 55 yards. Britt Davis again makes the catch on the Horvath throw. Takes a big hit at the end of the play. I mean, gets absolutely belted.
That's a nose
by
tackle.
Terrence Banks.
Terrence Banks is a nose tackle.
He's one of the big uglies up front, and he hustled down the field.
A true freshman.
That's a motor.
Now, this is a great throw. Phil Horvath looks to his right, throws to his left. Britt Davis is left all alone. He takes a shot there, and he's got 6 owls around him, and that is a nose tackle. Now, he tackles him 25 yards downfield, but when you have a freshman nose tackle hustling down the field like that, that's effort.
At 275 pounds, you're exactly right. That's effort. Garrett Wolf into the seam. Garrett Wolf will pick up maybe 5 here.
Well, I think
David Fatherly.
It's just a matter of time before they start to create some space for Garrett Wolf. This offensive line has been too good. They did not play well last week against Western Michigan, but over the course of the year, your running back does not run for 195 yards per game when your offensive line is weak. This is a good front 5.
Look at Al Golden in his first year. Horvath fakes, looks, throws, got an open man, and that's going to be inside the 5-yard line. David Korokowicz made the catch, number 91.
Well, and even when they're not running the football well, you have to honor Garrett Wolf in the backfield. And Phil Horvath again, the play fake to Wolf. Little half roll, he finds Karankiewicz wide open. He decides, instead of running away from the Temple defender, he decides to run over him.
Garrett Wolf knocked down at the three.
Ball carried by number one, Garrett Wolf.
I think both teams need to check their chin straps.
I was about to ask you, did your helmet come off that much?
Yeah, and quite often my head came off inside of it as well.
There's Jason Onibuagu.
John Haley pressure with the tackle. No gain on the carry. Second down and goal from the 4.
You're going to get a chuckle out of that in film sessions tomorrow. That's not a solid pop where the helmet just comes flying off.
Timeout Temple. That is their second charge timeout. We're going to break with them. 2:36 to go. Huskies on the doorstep. Second and goal at the 4 when we come back.
Hey, Husky fans, shop online for all the latest Husky merchandise at naubookstore.niu.edu. We carry the best brands, gear, JanSport, Russell, Vantage, Zephyr, and more. Shop any of our 3 locations, the Home Student Center, the Convocation Center, and our newest location at the Barsima Alumni and Visitor Center, open 3 hours before game time for every home game. For the best Husky gear selection and prices, stop by today or shop online at niubookstore.niu.edu. That's niubookstore.niu.edu.
The new Arctic Cat ATVs. Not only are they the most versatile, also as tough as they come.
Do one more.
Arctic Cat, more to go on.
The Play Dirty sales event is going on now. Visit your nearest Arctic Cat dealer today.
Oh, I'd love to see that.
Welcome back in here to DeKalb as we're checking other scores and just...
I think your hatred for a...
Local team
that has gold helmets
came through.
As UCLA has a bit of a lead over Notre Dame, but you saw what's coming up at halftime. I'll be the professional broadcaster here.
Thank you. Second and goal at the 4. Garrett Wolf will be belted at the 5 and driven back. Chris Page made the tackle again.
Phillip Simpson blew this play up from the very beginning. Again, look at the penetration. Great job by Phillip Simpson shedding a block. And they have gang tackled all day long. They have struggled to defend the pass. But in shutting down Garrett Wolf, it's not just been one Temple out. It's been 3, 4, 5 guys on every running play.
Horvath throws and cannot find his man because there was outstanding pressure from Ryan Gore. And again, another trip inside the 5, and again they'll try for 3.
Well, they went back to the well. Little play action pass and the roll. And Ryan Gore sniffs this one out. Phil Horvath can't set his feet and get the ball to Brandon Davis.
Nendick looking for his 3rd field goal of the day. He has a miss from 50. That one's up, and that one's good. 16-0, Northern Illinois. 1:54 to go, first half. Tommy, they're running the ball a lot, Northern, to the right side. That means you're running away from Doug Free.
Well, they struggled running the football to the left. Doug Free and Chris Acevedo were struggling to get the Owls pushed off the line of scrimmage. This team does a lot of pulling, even with their center. Their center, their guards, the backside tackles, they are a misdirection running team. And when you have active, quick defensive linemen that can shoot those gaps, they can disrupt your running game pretty quickly. It takes a lot of discipline from this Northern Illinois offensive line to make sure that guys aren't coming across their face
to blow up some of their running plays.
The NIU Alumni Association Huskies scoring drive, 13 plays, 61 yards, took 5:54, rather lengthy drive, but it culminates in a field goal for Chris Nendick of 22 yards. Wolf now 13 carries, just 34 yards. Brown and Page, excuse me, Shelton and Page, the deep man. This one about a yard deep in the end zone, and this time Temple will get a return. Oh. And Temple gets a big return.
There's Freddie Keebler.
Freddie Keebler, the turf elf, takes Travis Shelton down.
Well,
he had a head of steam.
He had
up.
A seam, too. He did a nice job hitting this return. And then he had an opportunity to cut it back as well at the end. He just lost his footing. Showing some good speed. Almost looked like taking the ball from his left hand to his right hand tripped him up.
Throw and catch. Mike Holly, number 3, will make the catch. That'll move the chains of Temple first down in the hurry-up offense. Well, this is 32 to go.
Less than 2 minutes to play, but this is also a good way to take the steam out of the Northern pass rush.
Larry English, I'm watching him try to bull rush. And they're doing a bit better job at keeping him from getting to the quarterback.
Well, I think George DeLeon, the offensive coordinator for Temple, is going to have to talk with his offensive line coach, Bob Bicknell, at the halftime and say, hey, guys, we're going to have to help out Devin Tyler. He's a young man. He's a redshirt freshman. We got to give him some help out there. We got to get a back to come out and chip on Larry English, because Larry English is just destroying the flow of their passing game.
They'll call that incomplete, so a second and 10. DeMichael throws, finds Tim Brown out of the backfield, and he'll shuttle out of bounds at the 41-yard line.
Good decision there. Put themselves in a very manageable third and short and get out of bounds and stop the clock. With just a timeout left, they can maybe take one or two shots in the middle of the field, but got to play to the sidelines.
We've got a flag on the play here. Everything blown dead.
Before the play, ball start on the offense, number 73. That's a 5-yard penalty. Still third down.
Devin Tyler, the man guilty of the infraction. He's the man charged with blocking Larry English.
I'd be a little jumpy, too, if I was Devin right now. But you go again, you go from a very manageable third down and 3 to a third down and 8. And it looks like the Huskies are going to come after him again.
They do stunt. He takes a big hit. The throw was down there, but it looked like it was thrown just a bit behind him, Tom.
Well, I'm sure we'll show this. We'll show this to you again. The ball is thrown behind him, but Travis Shelton put his hands in a bad position to catch this football. He had his left hand low, his right hand high. And in that particular situation, you got to turn him around. The ball's coming at you. Your left hand's got to be high. Your right hand's got to be low.
So Temple will punt it away. Huskies will get it back with just over a minute or around a minute left.
Northern with 3 timeouts as well. Again, that 5-yard penalty killed the Owls.
And that one is going to roll into the end zone. So the Huskies will have it at the 20 with 1:01 left. Victor E. Husky comes up with the football.
I'm going to put him on a diet dog food. He looked a little pudgy. What's his name again?
Victor E. Husky.
If I had the telestrator, I'd be circling that spot right below the 1 there. I'd get Victor on some Iams light or something.
Maybe some egg whites.
Maybe some egg whites.
That's what I eat. Well, that hit as he throws, and he throws it out of bounds.
That's a good decision by a veteran quarterback. Feel the pressure, throw it in the stance.
With Terrence Knighton all over him. Good pressure. There he comes. takes a big hit, but able to get it out of bounds with a strong arm.
Right now, the Temple defensive line is getting the best of the Northern offensive line.
And the Northern offensive line, the Pittman protection crew, they like to call them, they were thought to be one of the best going. They've struggled the last couple weeks.
Last week at Western Michigan, they had been outstanding.
Horvath looking, throws, got his man. Move the chains, Britt Davis makes a catch, ball at the 38-yard line.
And with three timeouts, you can attack the middle of the field. They'll stop the clock to move the chains, and then they'll rewind it. But
that's why you hate to see guys use timeouts early when you really don't need to use it.
Because it forces you in that point to go again down the middle of the field.
Matt Simon makes the catch.
And they'll probably call a timeout here. There's no reason to kill the clock. There's no reason to down the ball. Don't give up the down. Just a great job of attacking the middle of the field. There's no reason for Phil Horvath at this particular time to panic. Plenty of time, plenty of timeouts.
Throws, looks for his man, the big guy, Brandon Davis, catches it, steps out of bounds, and the Huskies have it in business at the 23.
And that's good coaching as well, because Phil Horvath, after the pass to Matt Simon, looked over to the sideline, and basically they told him, do not spike the ball. See a great catch by Brandon Davis right there. But his coaching staff on the sideline say, hey, you've got plenty of time, get to the line of scrimmage, compose yourself, and don't burn a timeout if we don't have to.
Pressure, throws, got his man. And a real solid tackle, and I think the Huskies will use a timeout right here.
Good decision.
Cord Kavich made the catch, but
David.
We'll just call him David. David made the catch. And the Huskies take their first timeout of the half.
Again, I think this is a very good job by a quarterback and his offensive coordinator managing a situation. It's just a little drag route.
David Kornikavich
does a nice job.
Chris Page with the tackle.
And at this particular time, he doesn't need to get out of bounds because they have their three timeouts. And as you saw, they really only attacked the sideline one time, the corner route to Brandon Davis. That's the luxury, as you said earlier, of being able to collect your timeouts and not use them.
As I check the media guide, Kornikavich.
Isn't that what I said?
I don't know.
You weren't listening.
You've been hit a whole lot. Sometimes it comes out a little mumbly.
Well, let me get my dictionary out and see if mumbly actually exists as a word. Is that Goshen,
that's
Indiana, or Goshen?
Goshen, okay. Indiana.
Sophomore?
I'll just go with he's a second-year player.
Is it
second-year player?
Enough or enough? Of this,
or enough said.
Second and six, 29.4 seconds left.
I think we could use a timeout. Again, the middle of the field is an option with two timeouts left.
Horvath going to the end zone. Marcus Perez is just overthrown. He had him.
He did have him. I think the ball was a little too tall, but Marcus Perez looked like he mistimed his jump a little bit.
Now, did you wear the little stickers under your eyes?
I played so long ago, they didn't have them. Again, offensive line, while they may have not have created any space so far, well, that one's just thrown in the stands.
Sailed?
Yeah, it did. It sailed on him. The offensive line has done a nice job protecting Phil Horvath. And I apologize to Marcus Perez. There's no mistiming that jump. That was an uncatchable ball.
Horvath pressure, throws it up, and it will be out of bounds.
Another good decision. You don't like to see that again on third down. It looks like they're going to have to settle for another field goal. But Phil Horvath may have learned his lesson last week at Western Michigan, where he threw three picks.
I'll guarantee you, Joe Novak said to him, I don't want to see it again. Throw it away. Throw it all the way to Sycamore if you have to.
He's done a nice job throwing the football away, that's for sure.
Horvath's hold spot, Mendick's kick is good. 15.4 seconds left, 19-0 NIU.
Well, two surprises. Actually, several. I did not believe that the Temple defense was going to be able to slow down Garrett Wolf, and they've done just that. The Owls have come into today's game giving up 248 rushing yards per game. And they've been pretty stout against the run.
Let's go back to third down. Watch the block by Garrett Wolf. You think some guys might hang their heads because they're not having the day go the way they want? Watch number one. That is a guy who doesn't ever quit playing.
Well, and there's a guy in Ryan Gore that's not having a good day when you're blocked like that.
I mean, that was just a big time block.
We talked about it several weeks ago when we were here for the Ohio game and the Buffalo game. Talking about getting Garrett Wolf more involved in the passing game and asking him to block less and less. And they've done that over the course of the year. His catch total has gone up to 18 so far this year. But he's such a tremendous athlete, such a weapon. You just need to get him the football in space. That's why when people ask you, can this young man play on Sundays? He's not going to be an every down back in the NFL, but when you can run the football, you're durable, you can receive the football, and you're willing to stick your nose in and make a block like that, there's an NFL team that will find a place for Garrett Wolf.
Short kick comes down around the 14-yard line. And that will probably, let's see, 3 seconds, 3.9 seconds left.
Tackled by Reed Cunningham of the Huskies.
Garrett Wolf, his last six quarters, just 59 yards. And they'll run off the final 3.9 left. Temple goes to their locker room. NIU to their locker room. It's 19-0 Northern Illinois Huskies. We'll chat with Joe Novak in just a moment. Mark Scafidi will grab him coming off the field.
Pretty complete effort from this Husky defense. They came away with five or six sacks, a couple turnovers, but Joe Novak cannot be happy with the four field goals. Loves the 19-zip lead, but would like to have gotten some touchdowns as opposed to three-pointers.
Down to Mark with Joe.
All right, down here with Coach Novak. Your defense is doing a great job of creating turnovers, but the offense is having trouble getting in the end zone.
Well, we're getting down the field, or getting good field position, and all we're getting is field goals out of it, Mark. You know, we're four field goals and a missed field goal. That's not good. You got to get in the end zone.
Are you worried about Garrett in the first half at all, and is there any plan to get him more space in the second half?
Well, I'd sure like to, Mark. If you got some ideas, let me know, because right now we don't have enough, so we got to get him some room to run. We're not getting him picked up well enough.
All right, good luck in the second half, Coach.
Thank you.
Dave, back up to you.
All right, there you have it from Joe Novak.
He looks unhappy, but he doesn't look worried.
Correct. He's up 19, but I think he's concerned about the play of his old line. We'll take a timeout. We'll come back. We've got a lot to do. Plus a real cool chat with Garrett Wolf at halftime. Huskies 19, Owls nothing. You're watching Northern Illinois football on Comcast Sportsnet.
Team up with the Huskies. Join the Husky Athletic Scholarship Fund today, where your financial support assists in providing a world-class academic and athletic experience for 488 student-athletes.
54 Crescita Academic All-Americans.
Highest department GPA in the history of NIU athletics.
MacWest champions in football and men's basketball.
We can't reach our goals without the help of the Husky Athletic Scholarship Fund members.
Call 815-753-1923 for information on joining the HASF.
Stop on in. We've got what you need. Stop on in. You're on the run.
At Casey's, we don't do thin and skimpy pizzas. Casey's piles them up real heavy. All month, get free cheese breadsticks with the purchase of any large pizza. Come in now and enter to win the Snickers Casey's Super Bowl Celebration Sweepstakes. You and a friend could end up at Super Bowl 41 in Miami.
Stop on in to Casey's General Store.
Maybe you want a sedan designed for the driver. Or one that's also beautiful on the inside. Or one that can outrun the price of gas. There's a way to have all three. Introducing the 2007 Saturn Aura midsize sedan. Lease a new 2007 Saturn Aura XE for around $257 a month. Residency restrictions apply. Call for lease.
I'm Frank Portillo at Brown's.
I'm Tony Portillo at Brown's.
Brown's has been part of Chicago for generations.
Brown's crispy chicken is an original Southside recipe.
Brown's sandwiches are the best tasting in town.
Brown's Italian beef.
Brown's Italian sausage.
And Dad's favorite.
The beef and sausage combo.
All made the Chicago way.
And no one beats Brown's for value.
Right now, three's a wild. Three legs, three thighs, three biscuits, just $4.99. Great deal from Brown's.
That's the thing about Brown's.
It tastes better.
It tastes better.
After 70 years, it's the end of an era. Spalding's for Men is going out of business. Spalding's entire stock of fine apparel for men and women is now as much as 50% off and more. Come take advantage of unprecedented savings and great selection in this store-wide liquidation. It's Spalding's going out of business sale. Going on now at 110 North Marion Street in downtown Oak Park. You can't miss this sale.
To all NIU home athletic events.
Welcome back to our U.S. Cellular Halftime Report in DeKalb, where the score is 19-0, Northern Illinois over Temple. I'm David Kaplan. Folks, NIU tailback Jarrett Wolf continues to lead the nation in rushing, and he must be considered one of the key players in the Heisman race. But as Comcast Sportsnet's Chuck Garfine found out, the Huskies' diminutive superstar runner is more concerned with his team's overall goals.
When you got here, what were your expectations on the field? I mean, did you think you could do what you're doing now? Did you?
Well, not do what I'm doing now. I thought that I could be very successful. And an ex-girlfriend of mine, she was my girlfriend junior, senior year of high school, my freshman year of college. She remembered me telling her that I told her that I was gonna come here and take over. And I know I used to tell my family members that all the time. And I just had to wait for the time, when the time was right. It's kind of funny how things work themselves out.
Now you're 5'7", right?
Mm-hmm.
That's a true 5'7".
5'7".
You're on the field. You are usually the smallest person on the field.
Every time, there's never a guy on the field smaller than me.
And yet you do what you do. How are you doing it? And do you feel like that's a little bit part of your nature? You're on the field and you kind of like being the underdog.
I love it. Because in life, I'm the underdog in life. Wasn't supposed to make it out of my neighborhood. You know, not many people catch the bus an hour and a half to school and survive that. And not many people overcome the things that I've overcame to, get to where I'm at in life right now. And I've accomplished a lot, and the one thing that stands out to me is that, you know, I've had an unbelievable support system. But, you know, football is easy. Everything else, you know, that happened off the field, that's the stuff that's hard. Playing football and, you know, making people miss or running a guy over, that's easy.
Against Ball State, you run for 353 yards, and yet you could have run for more, couldn't you have?
Yeah, I know. I'm very aware of that. Everything just happened to line up that night. All the stars aligned perfectly for me that evening, and they just kind of worked themselves out in a weird way.
Do you think most people in this country know who you are yet?
If you're a fan of college football, you have to. I think with what I've been fortunate enough to accomplish, if you're ignoring it, you can't consider yourself a real fan of college football. You don't have to respect it, and I'm not sitting up here saying that everyone should respect what I do, because I'm really indifferent about that. You don't have to, but you have to notice what I've accomplished.
In the history of the Heisman Trophy voting, nobody in the MAC conference has ever been in the top three. What kind of upset would it be for you to win it? Are we talking Miracle on Ice, U.S. over Russia?
I think it'd be more. Not necessarily a miracle. I think it just takes a lot of people believing in what I accomplished is valid. But there are going to be people that make excuses. Well, he did this in the MAC. He did this here. He did this there. But one thing that people can't take away from me is what I've accomplished against Big Ten schools. I had 285 all-purpose yards against the Ohio State, the number one team in the country. How do you find a measuring stick better than that? There isn't one.
Hearing you talk, it sounds like you feel like you have something to prove to people.
Always.
Yeah. What is it?
That, you know, I can be successful regardless of what it entails, regardless of
where I'm at in life, you know, whether it be the football field, whether it be in the classroom, whether it be in life, that, you know, the odds have always been against me in every way of life that I can think of. And all I've done is overcome them. And, you know, I think that's what keeps me going, is never being satisfied. I just want to keep proving everybody wrong.
At the end of the day, what do you think you're going to accomplish in college? Where's this going to go? How's this story going to end?
Hopefully it ends with a ring, a nice piece of jewelry, which would mean we are MAC champions. And that's the ultimate goal. Heisman Trophy is great. Breaking Barry Sanders' record would be even better. But nothing beats the ring.
Well, Garrett Wolf, you talk about a guy who has overcome a lot and gives everybody reason to believe that the Huskies have a great one in their midst in DeKalb. We'll come back. We've got a lot more to do on our halftime. Huskies up 19 at the break.
You know, there are some things families just don't like to share.
They don't want to share this.
Or this.
Or these.
Or this.
That's why with U.S. Cellular's family plan, everyone in the family gets their own phone. Plus, they can talk to each other free.
Speaking of which, does anyone want to talk about these?
Oh, those are Dwayne's!
See, you thought you lost them.
U.S. Cellular, we connect with you. Right now, get up to 4 free phones when you buy one for only $29.95.
At Jewel, it's the fresh way we trim. Slice. Serve. The fresh way we grind. Prepare. Fish. It's offering the freshest variety. The best poultry, beef, pork. Seafood that's oh so fresh. And help from our experts in store. Top quality, great service. All fresh to your family from Jewel.
Advance your career with an MBA from Northern Illinois University.
I was able to balance my MBA with my professional life as well as my personal life. And best of all, NIU's MBA program is AACSB accredited and affordable.
I was impressed with the knowledge and experience of the professors, and the program provided me with a well-rounded business education. The affordability and convenient locations made my decision easy, and it made my MBA a reality.
Designed for the working professional, the MBA program at Northern Illinois University. Jumpstart your career today.
NIU, serving the heart of America's heartland. Educating new leaders for the nation's third largest region. Bringing expertise and innovation to communities and public schools. Creating new jobs and new workers. Conducting research that improves our quality of life. Northern Illinois University. Across the region, from Chicago to the Mississippi, NIU works.
Sharper details, stunning clarity, more vibrant colors. Discover what your camera's megapixels are really capable of.
Wow.
Upgrade to an ultra-high definition photo printer, only from Epson.
Welcome back to the U.S. Cellular Halftime Report here at Husky Stadium, where Northern Illinois leads 19-0 over Temple. I'm joined now down on the field with NIU's head wrestling coach, Dave Grant. Coach Grant, welcome to the halftime show.
Good to be here.
Your season kicks off in a couple weeks. You have this thing that's unique to Northern, a wrestle-off. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, in the sport of wrestling, you go head-to-head, and whoever wins that title match will wrestle for you. So we'll have our 25-pounder or 33-pounder on up to heavyweight. Number one and two second string guy go together, and whoever wins it will have the opportunity to start for the Huskies.
Now talk about your first match, which is November 11th. What are you expecting with that?
Well, it's the Stevens Point Open, and it's mostly a Division III team kind of tournament with Madison, Wisconsin. So we're the two Division I teams. It's a good opener for us because the following week we wrestle in one of the premier tournaments in the country. We have Minnesota, Oklahoma State, that's in Omaha.
And you also have three returning wrestlers who made a national appearance last year in the NCAA tournament. What are you expecting from those guys?
Well, Johnny Galloway was one match from being an All-American, had a great year last year. Mike Grimes was a national qualifier, and then Pat Costello. He's a junior. He's ranked in the top 20 right now. We expect big things out of him.
And more importantly, you also had a high academic team GPA, which is a big mark for any athletic team.
Well, we believe our hard work on the mat and hard work on the, in the classroom, they kind of connect. So typically our best wrestlers are our best students. So we look at our guys to be over 3-0, and we were 16th in the country, so our guys do a great job. We're real proud of them.
And something that should help the athletes not only on the field but also in the classroom is the new AAPC. What's that going to do for the wrestling program?
That's quite a building. I mean, the beautiful thing about it is it's they have classrooms, you'll be able to have tutors, and it's a half block from the dorms. So the kids will have great access to it. The new weight room will be 3 times the size, and then it'll open up some spaces for us in the stadium where we'll have a brand new wrestling room. And it could really take us to the next level, you know, from the top 25 to the top 10.
And we're here at the 100th homecoming here. What are the feelings you're getting from this festive atmosphere with NIU up big?
There's nothing like it. I mean, the fans, the crowd, it's just wonderful. And we're so proud of what Novak's done. We both came in at the same year, and that guy, he stands for integrity, and he works really hard with his athletes, and he's done a great job. He's really led the whole Husky athletic program in the right direction.
All right, thanks, Coach, for being our guest here at halftime. Good luck in the season. We'll be back with Tom and Dave up in the booth for highlights right after the half.
Husky fans, Fatty's Pub and Grill in DeKalb is your official pre- and post-game NIU football headquarters. Whether you're catching a game on our big screens or having some of our famous grilled food out in our beer garden, Fatty's is the place to be. Join us on October 21st for Fatty's Centennial Homecoming Outdoor Tent Party with Tripp and Billy's playing live on stage after the game. For more information, log on to fattyspub.com. It's all at Fatty's Pub and Grill, located directly south of Husky Stadium on Route 38 in DeKalb.
Looking for a wireless phone and service? The Phone Store features service from Sprint PCS, U.S. Cellular, T-Mobile, and Nextel. Why buy a phone from a store that offers only one carrier? At The Phone Store, our friendly, knowledgeable staff will help you compare between all of our carriers and help you find the phone and service that fits your needs the best. The Phone Store, with two great locations, in Rochelle next to Sullivan's Foods and in DeKalb on Sycamore Road next to Great Clips by Aldi, or call 815-78-PHONE.
Team up with the Huskies. Join the Husky Athletic Scholarship Fund today, where your financial support assists in providing a world-class academic and athletic experience for 488 student-athletes.
54 Crescita Academic All-Americans.
Highest department GPA in the history of NIU athletics.
MacWest champions in football and men's basketball.
We can't reach our goal without the help of the Husky Athletic Scholarship Fund members.
Call 815-753-1923 for information on joining the HASA.
This is a light bulb. Not all light bulbs are created equal.
This is a compact fluorescent light bulb, a CFL.
It uses about 66% less electricity and lasts 4 to 10 times longer, saving you money.
As part of our care program, ComEd is offering rebates on 1 million CFLs.
Get the details at ComEdCare.com. At ComEd, we're dedicated to delivering reliable energy.
At affordable prices. That's our promise.
That's our way. ComEd, an Exelon company.
If you love power, you'll love a Panasonic vacuum with power on demand. This exclusive feature automatically gives you more power just when you need it. In fact, your Panasonic vacuum might just become your new best friend. Panasonic. Ideas for life.
We are back at the half. The Huskies, a 19-0 lead over the Temple Owls. Welcome back, David Kaplan and Tom Waddle with you. And Tommy, pretty good first half for Northern in terms of the scoreboard. They can't be pleased with their O-line play.
Well, there's no question. Joe Novak happy with the 19-0 lead, but the 4 field goals not so happy with. He'd like to see his offense. When your defense gets 5 sacks, creates a couple turnovers, and gives you the ball in the plus territory, you've got to put that football into the end zone, and today they haven't done that so far. I know Joe would rather have touchdowns than field goals right now.
All right, let's take a look at some of the highlights from the first half. It was a good first half for Northern Illinois' pass rush. Let's check their offensive attack out first. Phil Horvath, Tommy, a big day.
Yeah, absolutely. He finds Matt Simon standing all alone in the end zone. Matt getting a little impatient, but absolutely they make the throw and the catch for the touchdown. It wasn't working running the football, so they decided to drop back and throw it. Phil Horvath, a nice afternoon, 16 for 25, 217 and a touchdown. But the story in the first half was the defense. You see Larry English, he was a monster out there. Four sacks, he forces a fumble. Again, the defense turned the football over, took the ball away twice, and unfortunately for the Huskies, they only came away with 3 points off those turnovers. But they have pressured DeMichael all afternoon long. They have shut down the running attack. And as I said, the Huskies haven't run the football well either. 13 carries for 34 yards. Garrett Wolf, and you see the Temple Owls swarming all over Garrett Wolf. Gang tackling. They've really done a nice job. They came into this ballgame giving up almost 250 yards per game on the ground, but they were outstanding in run defense in the first half. Something tells me the Huskies will get back to running the football in the second half. And you look at the numbers, talk about run defense, the Huskies defense. They held Temple to minus 10 yards of rushing offense overall. Husky defense played as good a half of football, I think, as they've seen or done all year long. I think this Husky team, yes, they're not happy with the 19-point lead, but they're where they want to be. They'll get back to running the football and playing great defense.
And I think for Temple, they had 3 first downs on their first possession, just won the rest of the half. What do you expect Novak and Sam Pittman, the O-line coach, do to get Garrett Wolf going?
Well, they're just going to have to ask their offensive linemen to follow the techniques they've been taught in practice and execute the plays. I mean, Garrett Wolf is just too good a football player not to give the football to him. You heard Joe Novak say when they got off the field at halftime, hey, our offensive line's got to create some space, and I think they will in the second half.
All right, let's take a look at our Fatties Max scoreboard. Fatties Pub and Grill here in DeKalb. Western Michigan all over Ball State, 38-20 in the third. Ohio annihilating Buffalo, 35-7 in the fourth. There's Eastern Michigan up early, 6-0 over Toledo, and then a later start for Miami of Ohio at Akron. Let's go back downstairs. Mark Scafidi with Coach Al Golden.
You guys have done a great job keeping them out of the end zone. How are you going to continue that and get some points on the board in the second half?
Well, I told the guys at halftime, we need to get 2 takeaways. I think we need to get 2 takeaways. We're doing a good job keeping Wolf in check, but that's his MO. We can't give him an explosive, and we got to protect the ball on offense. We're not doing a good job of that right now.
All right, good job in the second half, Coach.
All right, so there you hear from Al Golden.
He's got to be proud of his defense. As we said, 13 carries, 34 yards out of Garrett Wolf in the first half. They got beat up a little bit in the passing game, but trailing 19-0 at the half. Sounds bad. It could have been worse, though.
Now, Tommy, they have a very, very interesting promotion here with the first kickoff that Northern Illinois returns, whether that's the opening of the game or the opening of the second half. If they return the kick for a touchdown, somebody wins $100,000. It's brought to you by the fine folks, Rich Katz and everybody over at Resource Bank. Northern deferred in the first half. They are now going to receive here. Britt Davis and I believe, who do you have, Marcus Perez? Britt Davis and Marcus Perez
are holding hands,
praying. They've got 100,000 piled up, and some lucky winner may get 100,000 bucks.
A very returnable kick.
The sideline, and he's knocked out of bounds at the 48-yard line.
Greg's best friend, the kicker.
Greg Turner took the short kick, and we do have a flag on the play as well. Offsides on Temple.
They'll tack 5 yards, they should, onto the end of the return.
Can you imagine if somebody returned it and they had a penalty on Northern bringing it back?
Yeah, I can't imagine that.
That would be disconcerting if you were the one that had the 100,000 taken away because of an illegal block.
Now the offside's gotta come from the left side of the kickoff team, as everyone on the right side seemed to be following the rules.
So Northern Illinois with tremendous field position to start the second half. Al Golden not a happy camper at all with the officials on that call.
Well, he's wondering because the official on the other sideline, the Northern sideline's the one who threw the flag,
And it had to be called on one of the Temple kickoff coverage men
on the other side
of the field.
Correct.
How can the whole group miss that?
Well, you just heard Al. He's wondering how can the whole group miss that.
Ball carried by one Wolf.
And again, the second half starts as the first half ended, with the Temple Owls doing a nice job slowing down Garrett Wolf.
Andre Nettler with the Temple for the Owls.
Second and 10 on a no gain.
Defensive coordinator Mark D'Onofrio standing next to Al Golden right there. It's a very talented, hardworking, good recruiting young staff that will pick this Temple program up.
Horvath steps, evades pressure, finds Jarrett Carter. First down at the 25-yard line.
Well, they're not going to be stubborn, obviously. The running game's not going to work. Phil Horvath has got his rhythm today. He's done a nice job all afternoon long feeling the pressure. And the pressure has come all afternoon long from Phillip Simpson. But Horvath steps up, gets the ball out to Jarrett Carter, and a nice, once again, a nice positive play in the passing game.
Garrett Wolf up the middle. Garrett Wolf will be dragged back. And I mean, rudely dragged back. Brian Sanford, number 52, stepped in and threw him down.
Well, there's no question this Temple defense is not intimidated by the running attack of Northern Illinois.
And Horvath looking for Marcus Perez, incomplete. We're gonna have a special guest with us up here in the booth, Tommy. A guy who's a lot bigger and tougher than you and I.
Well,
certainly than
you don't have to be very big or tough to be bigger and tougher than the two of us.
Well, we'd like to welcome Hollis Thomas going into the NIU Hall of Fame and a long career in the NFL still going with one of the surprising teams,
well,
Hollis.
Maybe a surprise
so
to you.
Surprise now?
No, 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 not to me, because I was one of those that said that I thought the New Orleans Saints at the start of this season were going to be the biggest surprise in the NFL.
Did I not say that?
You got it on tape?
Solely because of you.
We actually do have it on tape on our radio show.
I do think Reggie Bush and Drew Brees and some
of the star power. So,
yeah, they do.
Know, and they have great players and stuff. And, you know, they work hard.
Touchdown, Northern Illinois.
You brought some good luck to the booth.
Hollis, congrats on getting into the Hall of Fame. That's a very cool honor.
Oh, thanks. It is an honor and a privilege to be considered one of the. He wants y'all to do the replay.
Absolutely. You can take us through the replay if you want. It's Horvath.
Horvath
does a nice job evading the rush.
Yeah, great job evading the rush. And he just gets some yak there.
A little yak yard after the catch
for Greg Turner. Nendick will try the extra point, and the Huskies have blown this one open now. Pending the PAT, it'll be 26-0.
Sweet.
It is good. 26-0. More with Hollis right after we take a timeout. Northern Illinois finds Peter. 12:56 left in the third in DeKalb, Illinois.
My wife works hard. The kids are 10, 6, and 3. Our life together gets a little crazy. So I called Applebee's like I've done before. They brought our favorite foods out to my car door.
With Applebee's Carside To Go, you call it in, we bring it out.
Now my wife runs to meet me just as fast as she can, cause there's something women like about a pickup man.
Applebee's Carside To Go. It's not fast food, it's Applebee's food fast.
It seems that no matter where we go or what we do, we always take my Land Rover LR3. Like when my daughter had to transport her ambitious yet prize-winning science project, it was, let's take mine. When the wife's six extra-tall relatives made a surprise visit, I took them to her sister's. In mine. Took mine. Took mine. When we went on a supposedly sun-filled vacation, we just had to take mine. And when the clouds finally parted, I'm glad we had mine.
Always be glad you took yours. The LR3 by Land Rover. Designed for the extraordinary. Visit your local Land Rover center.
Welcome back. We are in the third quarter here in DeKalb. The Huskies all over the Temple Owls. 26-0. David Kaplan, Tom Waddle, Mark Scafidi, our man on the sideline, and this good-looking gentleman,
the tank, they call Hollis Thomas, into the Northern Illinois Hall of Fame. Had a great, great career here. And tell us a little bit about your foundation. You won the Burt Bell Award as doing just tremendous things for the community among all NFL players. That's a great honor.
I just wanted to give something back to the community. And actually, my foundation is teaming up with another former NIU player, big time sports. Name's Wade White. Used to be 55 here with me. That's like on all those highlights. The guy you see slapping me around, I was running from him because he always slapped me. But we teaming up because there's no youth football here in DeKalb, so we're going to bring youth football here to DeKalb as part of my family, giving back to the community. But we do a lot of different programs, helping kids with athletics and reading and learning how to fill out job applications and stuff. And, my sister, she's probably like the biggest part of it. She's the chairperson. And,
big game for Temple there. Big yardage.
Had to be exciting for you at halftime to be honored in front of the crowd here. That's something very special.
It was a great feeling, coming. You just gonna get me walking off the field like that? It was great. It was great to come back and be on the field again.
A little different surface these days, isn't it? This field turf.
Yeah, we actually play. Most of the NFL fields are like that now. So they're doing some great things here. The program, they're building the program up very well, and we're starting to get recognized nationally. So
now, the New Orleans Saints, as we were saying earlier, Tommy, my partner, said early, that's the team to watch in the NFL. How are you enjoying that experience? And the night when you guys reopened the Superdome was one of the most emotional nights I've ever seen in a football game.
Oh, yeah. Well, everybody was jacked. The fans, we were on an unbelievable high. And, it was a tremendous feeling. I can't describe to you in words, how it felt to be out there, especially on the field. And when you made a play and the crowd was yelling your name out and stuff, it was just indescribable. But as far as, our season, it was something we knew we could do that we just had to go out and do. We felt like we were in training camp doing all the OTAs, and all the OTAs is off-season training.
The optional things that everybody goes
optional,
through.
Yeah, optional, yeah. Well, doing those, we were working extremely hard, and we felt like we were working harder than any other team, and felt like we weren't doing it for nothing. So we felt like if we come out, play hard, and play hard and play to the fourth quarter.
Look at you, back in the day.
That's against Florida.
That's against OSU.
Wow. Now, did you ever imagine from the days here in DeKalb that you'd end up with a long-storied career in the NFL? I know you always hope to, but you hope for the best. Sometimes it doesn't always happen, but it has happened for you.
It seems like yesterday that I was just a rookie in the NFL and, sending this tape around, and it just turned around and it's 11th year, so... It's like each year I set out. If I set out and I work out, and I don't feel like I want to quit. So, as long as I'm not playing in the fourth quarter of a preseason game, then I know there's still a chance.
An outstanding decade with the Philadelphia Eagles. You actually survived the T.O. Donovan McNabb experience last season, right?
Yeah.
That was comment, right?
Yeah, it was an interesting time. It was two guys that had a difference of opinion. And they didn't work it out amongst each other, so it kind of broke the team up.
Isn't it nice to be in a harmonious locker room right now down in New Orleans, where Sean Payton has done an excellent job creating harmony in there?
Yeah, he's done an excellent job of adding some older guys and some young guys. And, we got a nice, tough team. And we want to be a force to be reckoned with.
A fourth and two situation. Al Golden down 26, says we go. And now they take a timeout.
These were moments that Hollis lived for, fourth and two.
fourth and two. You figure they're going to try to run something up the middle. He's going to try to drop back for a pass, so you want to hit the gap hard.
In terms of looking back at your experiences here at Northern Illinois, how did you enjoy your time from your freshman year when you come in, you're wide-eyed, thinking, I want to play some college football, too? Your final year, you knew you had a chance to go on.
Well, I knew I had a chance. There was a lot of scouts coming by, looking at me, and I did a lot of working out. Obviously, when I didn't get drafted, I was kind of sad. But I felt like,
did that motivate you?
It actually did motivate me, and I just wanted a shot to go in there and show them what I could do.
And then you got your bye week. You come back to DeKalb, and things looking up for the New Orleans Saints.
Yeah, going into the bye week, we felt like we needed this game going into the bye week just to, you know, prove to the rest of the world that, you know, we're for real. And we're going to fight to the end of every game, no matter if you're up on us or not.
Well, you have to be excited the direction this Northern Illinois football program has taken with Joe Novak looking for their seventh consecutive winning season.
Most definitely. This is a great thing. I'm not the laughing out of the locker room anymore.
What else do you do on the bye week? Are you going to get a chance to get out in Chicago at all?
Actually, after this game, we're going to go to Chicago a little bit. I'm a little old to be hanging around on college campus, so.
No McCabe's for you tonight.
I actually was here last night at some little club, and I was like, whoa, I am old. And then I realized I was old also when they was referring to me as a legend. I was like, a legend? I'm not done yet.
That's right. Tempo goes incomplete. The Huskies will take over. Hollis, we appreciate you taking the long climb up here for us.
Oh, yeah, that was a jolt.
Yeah.
Yeah, I just caught my breath after the break.
It's like an afternoon practice at training camp.
Tell Coach Payton you did your working out while you were off.
Now I don't have to do that cardio back at the hotel.
That's exactly right. All the best.
Oh, thanks, man.
Thanks for everything that you've done for the community here.
Thanks, man.
All the best to you.
All right. I'm going to take this thing off now.
Yeah, you can have it. Take it with you.
Take it with you. Hollis Thomas of the New Orleans Saints.
And that's the truth. Did I not tell you coming into this season that the New Orleans Saints were going to be the biggest surprise in all of the NFL?
Yes, you did. And I believe Dan Nicholson is coming in at quarterback for Northern Illinois. And he's going up top right away and finds his man. Move the sticks, the Huskies.
Well, this is a different Northern Illinois team than we've become accustomed to watching. A run first, throw second attack. Most Saturdays, today it has been throw first and run when you want to. Dan Nicholson steps up, makes a good throw, his first of the day. Finds Marcus Lewis, who again does something I like to see from wide receivers. Doesn't step out of bounds, turns it upfield, and gets a few more yards.
Garrett Wolf breaks a tackle. Garrett Wolf will rip off 9, maybe 10. We'll see where they spot it.
Brought down by George Coleman.
Boy, he benefits a lot from his vision, but he also benefits at times from being 5'7" and being able to hide behind his offensive tackle. It's just a great play. Great sense to bounce outside. He's got to be a little frustrated today after a difficult week at Western Michigan last week. Just has not been able to get on track today as well.
But I got to think he stays in the game till he gets to 100.
Oh, absolutely.
No doubt. Wolf takes the handoff, crashes across the 30-yard line. It should have enough to move the chains.
Well, again,
see where the spot is.
The Husky offensive line making
some
mistakes.
Nope, he's going to be short.
Terrence Knighton just turned free. Nobody blocked him.
They will call it a 3rd and 1.
You see Phil Horvath standing on the sideline. Doesn't look like he's going to be given the rest of the afternoon off. He still has his helmet on.
Hanging out with Ryan Morris, number 15, a freshman quarterback. Nicholson will move the chains, and that is a Northern Illinois first down.
Looks like he's about to run out onto the field.
I think he wants to go back in.
I tell you, I give Garrett Wolf a ton of credit. I mean, he is a class individual. Even when times are difficult, you never see him complaining. You never see
hangs
him,
his head.
Never hangs his head. You never see him yelling at his offensive line or his quarterback. He carries himself with tremendous class.
Nicholson looking. Hit as he throws. Belted down.
Terrence Knighton again.
Nicholson's pass.
Wolf
complete.
Right now, 17 for 45 yards. 17 carries, 45 yards.
You'll see once again just a great swim
Nicholson
move.
Hit on the play by 92, Terrence Knighton.
Terrence Knighton finds his way to the quarterback, slips Chris Acevedo, and they are very active up front.
Second down and 10 from the 24.
Philip Simpson, number 94, a redshirt sophomore. Terrence Knighton, a true sophomore. Brian Sanford, a true freshman. They're young and active up front.
Boy, Hollis Thomas is a big man.
He is.
Wow. Thick. Nicholson looking, going up top. He's got his man. Touchdown,
tremendous touch on this post pattern. This throw was fantastic.
Well, he just floated it right into his hands.
Temple with no free safety in the middle of the field, an all-out blitz. And you see just a great throw. Jarrett Carter goes up and gets it. But Dan Nicholson just drops it in. Perfect placement.
Extra point good. Nicholson to Carter. They hook up for six. Huskies 33 zip. 8.5 to go in DeKalb.
Ask a few of your friends what they thought after having LASIK eye surgery at the Hauser Ross Eye Institute.
Yeah.
And you might hear something like this.
Yeah, it's one of those things that until afterward, I don't know how I got along without it.
You know, my biggest question for my doctor at Hauser Ross is why did I wait so long to do this?
Find out why so many people have trusted the Hauser Ross Eye Institute for LASIK eye surgery. Call 1-800-CHECKUP today.
Hey, Husky fans, shop online for all the latest Husky merchandise at naubookstore.niu.edu. We carry the best brands, gear, JanSport, Russell, Vantage, Zephyr, and more. Shop any of our three locations, the Home Student Center, the Convocation Center, and our newest location at the Farsima Alumni and Visitor Center, open 3 hours before game time for every home game. For the best Husky gear selection and prices, stop by today or shop online at niubookstore.niu.edu. That's niubookstore.niu.edu.
No credit, bad credit, short time on the job, bankruptcy. You've heard it all before. We've created a new concept in car buying. The old way of shopping for cars was where you go from dealer to dealer, hoping that one of them will get you financed, wondering what your payment will be, and what kind of car you're going to end up with. The Car Academy does just that. We have relationships with over 30 national lenders, most of whom specialize in Tier 2, less than perfect credit.
33-0, Huskies over Owls, 8.5 left third quarter. And the NIU Alumni Association Huskies scoring drive. Six plays, 55 yards, took 216.
Once again, they're doing it through the air.
Jarrett Carter's first career touchdown. Nendick's kick. This one will be short. Come down right around the 20-yard line. Temple should have reasonable field position at the 25 or 26-yard line. Huskies want to send a shout-out to Len DeTomo. I'd like to say hi to Len DeTomo watching today's game in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, home of the Temple Owls. I'm actually going,
hello
there next,
to Len.
Going there next weekend. It's my
great
wife
city
for the weekend. I've never been to Philly.
Very nice city.
So I will be there. And also a shout-out to John and Genus watching at the Eggshell Cafe up in Deerfield.
I would have enjoyed my time in Philly more had we played at Lincoln Financial Field as opposed to the old Vet.
Where the old Vet,
the drop-off in the end zone was like 4 inches in spots. Thank goodness I didn't spend much time in any end zone in my career, but people told me that it was pretty bad.
Tim Brown, the ball carrier. He's been a workhorse today.
He has.
Brad Benson and Larry English with the tackle.
He's done a nice job so far this year, averaging over 90 yards per game on the ground. It's been tough going today. Temple had minus 10 yards rushing at the half.
Simon, Turner, and Carter today, all their first career receiving touchdowns. You remember your first? Oh, please.
There were
probably
so
plays
many
on your doorbell.
There were so many.
Ring the doorbell. Touchdown, Waddle. And that one's incomplete.
Yeah.
Let's go down to our man, Mark Scafidi.
I'm sure
he
remembers all my touchdowns.
Absolutely. Mark?
Yeah, I don't know if I remember all of Tom's touchdowns, but I remember a couple.
You've got the leaflet, right, with the highlights?
He was passing out flyers before the game with all of his highlights, so yeah, I don't know if Dave got that one.
Benji, our producer, just said it's not hard to remember two, is it?
It seemed longer on the sheet you gave me. But Coach Pittman, the offensive line coach for Northern Illinois, was reinforcing to the troops to not give up a sack today. Also, they wanted to make sure that they tried a little bit harder to spring one for Garrett, who can hopefully bust one loose and get some big yardage out of it. Dave?
All right. Thank you, Mark. Pressure coming, and DeMichael is going down again. And I believe Larry English and Craig Rush were involved.
I think Anthony Antonacci is going to get a little bit of credit
DeMichael
for this one as well.
Is set by Benson and English.
It's just been a relentless pass rush from the Huskies. I said earlier in the broadcast, actually, it's Brad Benson providing the pressure at first.
And then Rush and English clean it
That's
up.
Right. Huskies come in today with to this game with just 12 sacks.
You know what? He may be cramping, but you're not hurt when you got a big grin no. on your face.
Well, I don't know if that was a grin or a grimace.
That was a grin.
It's not warm enough to be cramping today.
That was blocked. You can see it coming all the way. That was another bad snap. And it will be down at the 26-yard line. Dustin Utchick got it. Tommy, they've had trouble with the long snap all day long, and here's another one that sails. By the time Brownell catches it, no chance.
The punter has to be aware when the punt snap comes back a little bit less than directly at you. You've got to be real quick, and it just looked at that point that Brownell just took his time kicking it. Great job by Dustin Utchick to get in there and block the kick, but I talked about it earlier as well. When you're struggling on offense and defense, sometimes you'll find some solace in the play of your special teams. And prior to that punt block, the Temple special teams had actually performed fairly well.
I believe Cass Prime now in a tailback, so Garrett Wolf's day may be done.
Well, most people will tell you that there are no moral victories in sports, but when you're 0-7 and you're a program that has been torn down and you're building it back up, when you hold a Heisman caliber tailback to less than 50 yards rushing, I'd say that's a moral victory for the front seven of Temple. And you see Garrett Wolf on the sideline smiling. I mean, there's a young man, 17 carries, 45 yards, a horrible day by his standards.
But he really just had nowhere to run.
He's just happy his team's up 33-0. It's just the type of player he is.
That one incomplete. Nicholson's
pass
drilled.
That's
Turner, the intended receiver.
That's a sophomore mistake there. Obviously, he was pressured, but moving to his right and throwing off balance to his left usually ends in a disastrous moment.
Brian Sanford, who's been a real thorn in Northern side today, was the guy there.
It's hard to say. There have been some bright spots in a 33-0 ball game. But the Temple run defense has been outstanding, and at times they have pressured the Northern quarterbacks.
Nicholson on 3rd and 8, looking, throws, got his man. Rick Davis to the end zone, give him 6, touchdown, NIU.
But Northern's done a great job all afternoon long, whether it's been Phil Horvath or Dan Nicholson. They've done a great job attacking the middle of that Temple defense. Nicholson's got time to throw, steps up, sets his feet, and then just a great individual effort right there by Rick Davis. Like there was a coverage mix up in the Temple secondary, but
Britt Davis to the end zone. Nendick trying to make it 40-0, and he is perfect. 4-0, 40-0, NIU. They celebrate on the sidelines. And we've still got a long way to go in this one. 5:13 left in the third. It is all NIU. It's a happy homecoming in DeKalb.
Looking for a wireless phone and service? The Phone Store features service from Sprint PCS, U.S. Cellular, T-Mobile, and Nextel. Why buy a phone from a store that offers only one carrier? At The Phone Store, our friendly, knowledgeable staff will help you compare between all of our carriers and help you find the phone and service that fits your needs the best. The Phone Store, with 2 great locations, in Rochelle next to Sullivan's Foods and in DeKalb on Sycamore Road next to Great Clips by Aldi, or call 815-78-PHONE.
The verdict is in. The College of Law at Northern Illinois University is one of the nation's most respected law schools. At NIU Law, top students are part of a tight-knit, dynamic, and diverse learning community. Small classes give them unmatched access to some of the best legal scholars in the country, and state-of-the-art technology prepares them for today's courtrooms. Many NIU Law students even get hands-on legal practice before they graduate. That's why so many successful lawyers and judges hold degrees from the NIU College of Law. NIU Law. Discover the difference.
Welcome back. David Kaplan and Tom Waddle with you up here in the booth. Mark Scafidi is prowling the sidelines. It's a happy bunch of Huskies today with a 40-point lead. NIU Alumni Association scoring summary. Coming up after this kick, a short pooch kick. Come down at the 22, and Temple will have it at the 35-yard line. NIU Alumni Association scoring drive for the Huskies. Three plays, 23 yards. Britt Davis, a 21-yard strike from Dan
Josh
Nicholson.
Scratching my head, rubbing my eyes, not because I have any type of condition. This is not the Husky team that I'm accustomed to seeing.
No, it
looks 367 like total yards from the Huskies today on offense. The majority of those throwing the football.
Temple takes over.
Garrett Wolf with just 45 yards rushing.
Right, you feel like BYU came.
Absolutely. And defensively, this is by far the best we've seen the Huskies play all year long.
Larry English among the men in there. A lot of red shirts. And the Huskies are saying a football came loose. But I do not believe the officials are concurring, are they?
No. Good thought. Temple really has just failed to establish their running game today. Minus 16 yards rushing to this point in the ball game. Look at this, total yards 367 to 62. And as I said earlier, the majority of those Husky yards are through the air, something we were not expecting.
Wide receiver screen, Shelton's got it. Shelton's gonna head to the end zone. Shelton down the sideline, Shelton. Will break up the shutout. Touchdown, Temple.
Travis Shelton has got a fourth and a fifth gear.
Boy, he can motor.
Just,
wow.
just a little bubble screen. We saw it earlier in the game.
I think it was Dustin Utchik had a shot at him.
And he had an angle, but Shelton, just watch. He gets to the second level, and you're just not going to catch him. Great effort by Utchik, but Travis Shelton with way too much speed.
Brownell for the extra point. Snap is fumbled. And it's DeMichael, the quarterback, and he's going down. Dragged down by David Bryant, number four.
Yeah, these are the moments that really anger your head coach. It's just a simple extra point. It's a horrible snap. DeMichael does everything he can.
Tommy, they've had five bad long snaps today. Every punt has been an adventure.
Well, Travis Shelton did his part.
Yes, he did. Let's take another look at the touchdown. Tell us exactly what happens.
Again, it's just a bubble screen. He gets to the outside. He gets a nice block from Mike Holly, who creates some space. Mark Ryder misses a tackle. And God bless Dustin Utchik for the effort, but you are not going to catch Travis Shelton. Talked about it earlier today. This Temple team has some serious athletes. They're just trying to put it all together right now. Was there something you wanted to add?
Not at all. I never ran the bubble.
Oh, okay. Two plays, 65 yards. Well, they doubled their offensive production. They came into that drive with 62 yards of offense, 65 yards on that drive. My math says that's 127 yards.
This one will come down in the hands of Britt Davis. Britt Davis trying to turn the corner, be knocked down about the 17-yard line. That's where the Husky attack will begin. leading by 34 points, 3:41 to go in the third.
I think you're going to see possibly some wholesale changes on the offensive line right now. Time to get some of the second and third team guys some activity, some experience. Maybe some guys on the offensive line auditioning for a job, because if the first string offensive line doesn't perform any better anytime soon, Joe Novak's going to have to make some changes. As good as they were through the first 6 weeks of the season, when Jarrett Wolf averaged 224 yards per game on the ground, they struggled last week against Western Michigan. They've struggled today against Temple, a team that was very suspect against the run. Maybe teams have found something by watching film that they are now exploiting.
Big Tony Holmes, a freshman out of Woodbury, Minnesota, number 66, is in on that O-line. And you're right, Tom. Sam Pittman, I was talking with Bob Kamel this week. You remember Bob?
Sure.
Coached here, coached at Northwestern, coached at Michigan, long run at Notre Dame. He said, from what he's heard, and in his opinion as well, from NFL guys, Sam Pittman is top five O-line coaches in the country.
Well, he's done a fantastic job, and they ask their offensive linemen to do a lot. You have to be an athlete. You have to remember Brian Van Acker, a very athletic center that played here for years.
Well,
graduated last year.
Well, he pulled more than any center we've seen.
That's right, and Eddie Adamski, who's playing center for them now, has had to do the same thing. They ask their offensive linemen to be very active up front. They do a lot of misdirection. They do a lot of things that, you know, you have to be good with your technique and you have to be able to run.
Cass Prime rips off a 13-yard run, but it's coming back for a hold.
Now you see it. I'll tell you what, you better keep your chin strap buckled, because this Temple team's going to hit you. At times they may hit you 10 yards downfield, but they're going to hit you.
Let's go back down to the sideline. Our buddy Mark Scafidi, what do you got, Mark?
All right, Brad Benson, his day is over, not because of the big blowout, but he's out with a left calf injury. His return is not going to be today. Maybe next week against Iowa, guys. Back up to you.
As I told you, Cap, it was not a smile. It was a grimace on Brad Benson's face.
I guarantee you he was smiling when he watched that highlight. He just forced a sack. I guarantee it was a smile.
There you go, Greg.
Those of us that have been down on the sideline, Tom, can tell.
Covering the game?
That's exactly right.
I have to tell you, I'm a bit surprised to see Northern still throwing the football, especially with some of their backup offensive linemen. You would figure you'd try to get them some experience running the ball. But attacking this Owl defense through the air has certainly been the way to go today.
Second and 13. Nicholson stumbles, goes down. Might have got his foot stepped on by one of the old linemen, tough to tell.
Freddie Keebler on the play.
Freddie Keebler, the turf elf, may have gotten him. And it will bring up a third and long. You know, we haven't talked a lot about Joe Novak today, but we did early, but he is such a solid football coach.
Yeah, he is.
And his teams are always competitive. You look at Joe right there shaking his head. He's just done a wonderful job with this program.
He has. I think that much happier with the defensive effort today than in recent weeks, because at times they have struggled. They played well last week against Western Michigan, but defensively this year, they just haven't come up with a ton of big plays most of the season.
And that one's going to be intercepted. Intercepted.
Again.
I think it may have been tipped. Philip Simpson.
That's a 6'2", 275-pound defensive end who's dropping off in coverage. Now, they're doing some exotic things defensively with Mark D'Onofrio, their defensive coordinator. Just a great pass rush once again, and a bad decision by Dan Nicholson to let the ball fly. You got to eat that, or you got to throw it in the stands. But again, let's go back to this catch right here. That's a defensive end, people.
That's a big time
play.
That's
a solid catch by anybody.
That's a big time play.
I keep going back to the same concept that this is a Temple team with some athletes. It's just going to take some time to put this thing all together.
DeMichael's going up top. Got a man. Touchdown, Temple.
Well, at 40 to nothing, this
Travis Shelton.
This Northern team has gotten sloppy.
Travis Shelton.
If you doubted before whether or not this young man has the speed to get behind your secondary, I don't think you're doubting it any longer. They just turn him loose. Just a little play action pass, a little stutter and go, and Mark Ryder, the safety, just comes up and bites on the run fake. Travis Shelton all by himself. Second big play in the last 5 minutes by Shelton.
DeMichael will lead his troops to the line. They go for two.
I don't think they trust their long snapper or their short snapper any longer. But he's open again.
Got him.
Just a little yo-yo motion. The defensive back got lost in the wash.
Shelton, four catches now for 116. Three catches for 114, and then he got the 2 point.
And he sets his
fourth reception.
He went in motion, came back, set his feet, come across the ball, and you see Adriel Hansbrough just got lost in the wash.
Take a look at the touch again, Tommy.
Well, for the second time in a few minutes, Temple strikes with a big pass play, and it's set up by the run fake. And again, Mark Ryder just doesn't get himself in position. Travis Shelton, too much speed. A little bit of a settle and go route by Travis Shelton. A couple things for Temple to be excited about. They played great run defense today. They have found an athlete, Travis Shelton, that can be their big play guy. As you see, their coaching staff talking with Adriel Hansbrough right now. Hey, listen, if he goes in motion, you got to stay with him, even if he crosses the ball and comes back. Well, I think Adriel's going to be unhappy when he sees the film tomorrow.
Brownell's kick will come down at the six. Perez turns the corner, a big return out over the 45-yard line.
I think Thomas Hammack, former fantastic running back from Northern Illinois, may have taken a spill.
Watch this return as he hits the seam. Good blocking.
Does a nice job setting up his blocks there and just being an athlete. Get that football on your outside arm, Marcus.
That's right, Thomas.
Expose yourself.
Take a bit of a spill.
Expose yourself to fumbling there.
Husky ball, first and 10 from their 48.
Nicholson hands the cast prime. That will go nowhere.
There is nowhere to run. You see Matt Rogers, he's a starter. You see Doug Free, he's a starter. You see Jason
Oni Buagu,
he's in there. He's a part-time starter.
Second down 10 from the 48.
They've got some of their top players on the offensive line in the game right now.
Nicholson looking, goes up top, got his man. Greg Turner.
Catch made, Nicholson to Greg Turner.
And that will be the final play, perhaps. Nope.
I think offensive coordinator John Bond has said, hey, guys, let's just not be hard-headed. For whatever reason, Temple's got our number in the running game today. We're going to throw it.
That should be the final play of the third quarter. They will run the clock down after they spot it. First and 10 when we come back. One quarter to go. Huskies by 26. Temple showing some signs of life as we head to quarter four.
NIU fans, when you enter the Village Commons bookstore, you're entering Husky territory. BCB is the official site for NIU athletics, featuring the new NIU logo on a wide range of hats, t-shirts, shorts, sweats, and NIU logo gifts and accessories. Whether you're a student, graduate, or a fan of NIU athletics, the Village Commons bookstore is your Husky headquarters. Visit us in DeKalb or call us toll-free 800-700-4868 or on the web at www.bcbs.com.
There are loads of good reasons to shop at big department stores, but home exercise equipment isn't one of them. Leave that to Chicago Home Fitness. And now during our anniversary sale, save up to $800 on the Midwest's biggest selection of quality ellipticals, starting at just $399. Plus, get 12-month interest-free financing. It's all part of the anniversary sale at Chicago Home Fitness, Chicago's most trusted source for exercise equipment.
Hi, I'm Desmond Roberts, president of Advantage Chevrolet, and here's why we can't be beat.
Because the prices are falling faster than the leaves during fall dealing days. How about a Malibu for just $216 per month or an Equinox for only $238 per month? Remember, zero down delivers, and with deep Advantage discounts, instant factory rebates, and available special financing, you just can't save any more anywhere else.
We're only minutes away at the corner of Joliet and LaGrange Roads in the Countryside Auto Mall. Thank you for your business.
Packed house here today, folks. The game was sold out this week for homecoming in DeKalb, the 100th year. They had a ton of great Husky celebrities last night at a big banquet. The Hall of Fame basketball coach John McDougal here last night. You saw Hollis Thomas, who we talked to. Jim Phillips is going to be up with us at some point here in the fourth quarter.
And he's so excited he can't take it because he gets personally $3 for every ticket sold, right?
Absolutely.
Isn't that the deal he cut with Northern? I know he's got every title known to man. Assistant Vice President of being Vice President of
Vice Presidents,
Secretaries, and
Athletic Directors.
Athletic Director, yeah.
Nicholson,
and rightfully so, I may add.
By the way, Justin Anderson's now in at tailback. Nicholson throws, has Brick Davis. He makes the catch on second nine and bring up a third and three or four.
Well, Temple's forcing Northern to throw the football because they are stacking the line of scrimmage and they are coming after the Husky quarterbacks, trying to create some turnovers. Britt Davis does a nice job getting rid of the jam at the line of scrimmage. Well thrown ball by Dan Nicholson as well.
How much of you getting rid of the jam, I mean, when you were playing,
it means everything.
Was it your hands or your footwork?
It's your footwork. You've got to be able to go 1,000 miles an hour in a 1 foot or 1 yard square. That's the key. You have to have quick feet. I was probably the slowest person on the face of the earth, but for whatever reason, I was able to move side to side quicker than anybody.
That's right. There's a difference between speed and quickness.
No doubt about it.
Yep,
if
said
you're
going
to play a slot receiver position, it's best for you to be laterally quick than it is for you to be vertically fast.
I was doing a game one day, and I said there's a difference. And the guy I was doing the game, I said, well, what do you mean there's a difference? It's either you're quick or you're not quick. Speed, quickness, all the same.
Well, you can have the fastest guy in the world who lines up on the outside, but a very good cornerback can jam him at the line of scrimmage, reroute him, and nullify his flat-out speed. But if you have a receiver that can shake and is quick and can move and contort his body in small spaces, then
foot quickness.
That's right.
Right.
But now, once you get past that cornerback, that ball's got to be delivered in 10 or 15 yards because ultimately then the cornerback with better speed is going to catch up with that wide receiver who may be quick versus fast. You following what I'm saying?
I got what you're saying, buddy, as you look at Al
Golden. I wish the game was played in a phone booth, personally.
Because you were quick
in that
phone booth.
Remember Rocky when they threw the chicken out in the pit?
Sure.
I could have caught the chicken.
And that may be one of the better running plays we've seen today.
Now, the chicken may have been ultimately, if you lined us up on the 40 and we ran to the end zone, the chicken's going to beat me.
Right.
But if you pin us in, I'm catching the chicken. Do you know what I'm saying? I had that kind of quickness, and that's what you need to be a slot receiver. Maybe I'm overtelling the story right now, but
the chicken would have beaten you, though, off the block.
There's no question. Flat-out speed, straight-line speed, a chicken's going to get me every time.
Is that why the chicken crossed the road to beat Tom Waddle?
I can tell you this. The chicken would have got hit. I wouldn't have.
You'd have been able to avoid
the
traffic.
I don't know why I say that, because the majority of my NFL career was not avoiding traffic.
So you were like the guy in dodgeball. If you get in traffic, Gordon.
That's right.
And avoid the cars.
Absolutely.
Or if you got hit, bounce back up.
I love your obscure references.
12:04, clock dripping under the 12-minute mark as we snap it here on a 3rd and 3. There is one of the great Husky dogs that prowl the sidelines here. They're just gorgeous animals. Nicholson going up and got Britt Davis. Breaks a tackle, breaks another tackle. Dragging tacklers inside the 5.
Tell you what, we've seen some great individual efforts today out of the Husky wide receivers. Britt Davis, Matt Simon, Greg Turner, Jarrett Carter. Nice throw too, good touch, gets it just over an Owl defender, and just watch Britt Davis just fighting for extra yards. All of these Husky wide receivers would rather run at the defender as opposed to out of bounds. Just a simple quick out route, does a nice job making the first defender miss. And then basically says, you want some of this, come and get it.
Something you've always talked to me about is you catch the ball with your fingertips.
Yes.
And that's exactly what he did there.
Earlier in the season, Britt Davis had trouble catching the football, so much so that Joe Novak sent him to an optometrist to have his eyes checked.
Actually an ophthalmologist.
I knew you were going to correct me.
But you're right, he had a couple. He and Marcus Perez both had drops for touchdowns in the Ohio loss.
And some may chuckle and say, oh, yeah, right, you're going to send him to get his eyes checked because he's dropping the ball. But honestly, there are a lot of people that play this game and play the wide receiver position who have benefited by having their eyes checked and
getting
having
the
appropriate prescriptions.
Huskies will run the football and be stacked up for no gain. I think it was Justin Anderson, the man who tried to make some progress there but was turned back. And we're going to talk with Northern's athletic director in just a moment. Jim Phillips will be up here with us.
Speak of the devil.
Speak of the devil. Ask and ye shall receive. Jim Phillips, the fine.
I want to know if it is true that you get $3 personally for every ticket sold.
Tommy said
that earlier.
Tommy said that you are vice president of all vice presidents. How's it going, buddy?
I have to tell you, I've been rubbing my eyes and scratching my head wondering which Husky team I'm seeing now. This is a team that historically has been run first and throw second. Today, they've had a great day throwing the ball, and they've struggled running it.
Well, I think as all good coaches do is I'm so proud of our staff. You have to react to the defense, Tom.
Absolutely.
And you know they are packing so many guys between the hash marks and between the tackles that, I mean, they're just taking the run away. So they're covering our guys one-on-one on the outside, and we're having to make plays.
Even with a 40-13 lead, you're throwing the football because Temple's forcing you to throw the football.
Right.
Well, 43-14, 10 and a half to go. More with Jim Phillips after we take a timeout. Homecoming Saturday on Comcast SportsNet.
Husky fans, Fatty's Pub and Grill in DeKalb is your official pre- and post-game NIU football headquarters. Whether you're catching a game on our big screens or having some of our famous grilled food out in our beer garden, Fatty's is the place to be. Join us on October 21st for Fatty's Centennial Homecoming Outdoor Tent Party with Trippin' Billy's playing live on stage after the game. For more information, log on to fattyspub.com. It's all at Fatty's Pub and Grill, located directly south of Husky Stadium on Route 38 in DeKalb.
Sharper details, stunning clarity, more vibrant colors. Discover what your camera's megapixels are really capable of.
Wow.
Upgrade to an ultra-high definition photo printer, only from Epson.
Welcome back in here to Brigham Field at Husky Stadium. David Kaplan, Tom Waddle with you, and Jim Phillips, the nattily attired gentleman here in the middle, the athletic director here and vice president of the university. And you got to feel good. You look around, the game was sold out. You didn't even have a walk-up crowd today. Everybody was coming with a ticket in hand. That's a great thing for football.
That's how homecoming should be. Sold out stadium, victory for the home team, a chance for all the former alums to come back and cherish the days that they walk campus and were in the classroom and it just is a festive weekend, and certainly the exclamation point is the victory today.
And an opportunity to see a program that will join the MAC officially in 2007. And I don't know how much contact you've had with Al Golden and his staff. Been a rough afternoon for Temple, but with that said, quality group of people and a quality program.
I can't agree with you more, Tom. I think it's a great addition for the MAC. Yeah. I think it's also great for Temple. They are playing a ton of freshmen and sophomores. And we're a perfect example of, we were 0-23 and 3-30 in Joe's first 3 years. It takes time. But I think that Coach Golden will do a great job. I love their athletic director, Billy Bradshaw, who was at DePaul in Chicago for a long time. So I think it's just a matter of time. They'll fit right in the MAC and do well.
I think you make a great point. I think the folks at Temple can look at the Northern program several years back and say, hey, maybe this is what we should strive for. And now Joe's looking for his seventh consecutive winning season. Yeah.
DeMichael blown up by Tim McCarthy. He was running for his life from Kenny West and Larry English, who's already got four sacks today. Well, by the way, today, Chris Nendick, 6 field goal attempts. That's an NIU record, and he's 5 for 6 on the day. The only miss from 50 yards.
I'm going to say at this point, Adam DeMichael should have taken a right instead of a left and gone out of bounds.
You feel that one tomorrow.
Well, you feel that one right now. That's a picture-perfect tackle.
If DeMichael.
If you're Tim McCarthy.
And he bounces that one in, and they'll call it an incomplete pass, bringing up a 3rd-and-2 situation. Things looking up. It was a good week for Husky athletics. You had everybody back for a banquet last night. Things are really on an uptick.
Really are, Cappy, and I'm proud of our coaches and our student athletes. But you talk about a great fall. Certainly we've talked a lot about football. We have a soccer program that's in the top 20. They're leading the conference. We have a volleyball program that's 8-1 in the league, 15-6 overall. They're leading the conference. So we got a lot of momentum right now in our fall sports.
DeMichael to the air, fires, and's got his man. I believe that was Shelton who made the catch. He's had a big day.
I have 3 young aspiring soccer players. How's the women's program going this year?
Really good, Tom. A young lady that some people know about, Marcy Miller, new head coach. She's also an Olympian.
Right.
She's traveling over to Korea today, as a matter of fact. So she's been in and out of our program. Her husband takes over the duties when she's away. But she is a world-class coach, and I think certainly a world-class athlete, and love the direction that that program is headed. And she's just been on our campus for 12 months, so she's just laying the foundation for, I think, a really bright future in women's soccer at Northern Illinois.
By the way, the attendance today, 27,039, as Larry English designs on his 5th sack. Instead, DeMichael, great footwork, evades him, goes long, and it's got his man Shelton again.
That young man can play.
He sure can.
And you'll watch this replay, which I'm sure Benji, our fine producer, will show us. And you'll see what he does. Travis Shelton. Again, a great job by Adam DeMichael getting away from the rush. But Travis Shelton does a great job defending, basically being a defender with his body, created space between himself and Mark Ryder. You'll see just body position, a little stop and go. But then plays a little basketball here. Just maybe gave him a little shove with the right arm, but does a very nice job positioning his body between the defender and the football.
3-back set now for Temple as they will try and get another touchdown on the board as this game drips toward the 8-minute mark. The outcome is not in doubt, but certainly the score is, as Temple has shown a little bit of life here in the second half. Shelton today, 5 for 182 and 2 touchdowns, and caught a 2-point conversion.
Well, they're looking for young men that they can build a program around, and Travis Shelton is a redshirt sophomore, so he'll be a part of this program for a few more years.
Your basketball team is today, a scrimmage. I think they're picked fairly high in the conference, so you got to be excited about things. How about on the women's side with Carol Owens?
I'm excited about both our basketball programs. Defending MAC West champs on the men's side. Rob's got a good group coming back, including James Hughes, who's getting a lot of attention from the NBA scouts, the defensive player of the year in the conference. Big 6'11", lanky young man that has already graduated last May. He's working on his second degree, so a terrific epitome of a student athlete. And then on Carol Owens' side, again, I'm not objective, guys. I think it's just a matter of time before that program takes off as well. She's just in her second year and certainly looking forward to the season.
All right, we're going to take a quick timeout. We'll chat with Jim for a little bit more. We'll be right back. Northern Illinois, 43-14, 7:46 to go here in DeKalb.
For over 50 years, Blaine's Farm and Fleet has been supplying families with all kinds of quality goods at low prices. And for those big bags of supplies you need for everyday life, no other store offers more. At Farm and Fleet, you'll find water softener salt, a big selection of food for your pets, lots of food for the birds, and their extensive line of agricultural feeds and supplements. You'll appreciate their tradition of convenience, quality, and value. For big bags and more, Blaine's Farm and Fleet is your store.
Are you Google-eyed with confusion over net neutrality? No wonder. It's all just clever mumbo-jumbo. Net neutrality is nothing more than a scheme by the multi-billion dollar Silicon Valley tech companies to get you, the consumer, to pay more for their services. Forget all their mumbo-jumbo. Net neutrality simply means you pay.
Would you like to stop paying your bills, to start over, to start fresh? The good news is, you can. The law offers you the opportunity to get rid of your bills. Don't you owe it to yourself to use it to your advantage? As the largest bankruptcy law firm in the country, let us help you with rising interest rates and late mortgage payments. And let us get rid of your credit card and medical bills once and for all. Let the new bankruptcy law work for you. Call 1-888-7-HELP-US.
Welcome back in.
Westside, baby. We clowning, baby.
Hey, Mom, I love you. St. Louis, baby. We representing. What's good?
Westside or nothing, baby.
MIA right here, baby. You know what I'm talking about?
Everybody having a little fun today.
Everybody's enjoying the TV cameras.
I have to tell you, Jim, we talked about, as Temple scores again, but we talked about Garrett Wolf, who has had a couple of rough weeks. Western Michigan last week and today really didn't get a whole lot done. Never see him complain. Never see him yell at his quarterback. Never see him yell at his offensive line.
He was smiling down there because they're winning.
He's happy to be a part of a winning afternoon.
He really is, guys. And I don't want to be over the top with him, but he is such a special young man. Certainly the talent on the field we talk a lot about, but he truly does care more about winning than he does about any talk about a Heisman or yardage or touchdowns. And that's the way you want it to be.
Absolutely.
Steve Maneri, number 86, the man that caught the touchdown pass. The snap, the extra point is good. So 43-20 now, 43-21.
Well, you give Temple a lot of credit. They keep fighting. And every touchdown is something to build on for them.
What do you have planned the rest of the weekend with the Husky homecoming festivities? A lot of people on campus.
We do. Men's soccer is back here tomorrow playing the Badgers of Wisconsin, so that'll be a great out-of-conference game for us. And continue on with the festivities, with the brunch tomorrow for our Hall of Fame inductees and their families. So it's been kind of a whirlwind this whole weekend with homecoming activities.
And then as you look towards next season, you'll have some changes in your football team. You'll lose some senior leadership in your quarterback, but you will have obviously no Garrett Wolf, but it'll be a different kind of football team.
It will, and I feel good about a lot of those kids coming back. We do lose those 14 seniors, but we got a nice stable of running backs coming back. You know, hard to replace Garrett Wolf. I don't think you ever do that.
But you got Clinton, who was out now with an injury. Cass Prime has been a good player. Justin Anderson.
Sure.
You've had some good running backs this year.
When you have prolonged success, your depth is going to improve drastically because kids are going to want to come to a winning program.
Right, right.
And Joe has done a fantastic job of creating that depth with his recruiting.
No question. And I love the quarterback with Danny Nicholson coming back. And that's another kid that you would know if he was the starter or the substitute. His behavior hasn't changed at all. He's come to practice every day and work and done his thing, and love to see him come in this afternoon and have some success at the quarterback position.
By the way, big day for Larry English, number 51 today. 4.5 sacks. He forced a fumble and recovered a fumble and did it all in the first half. He was outstanding today.
Gives him 7.5 for the season. Came in with 3, 4.5. Again, that math of mine from BC, Jim. Every now and then it comes into play.
The leading candidate for Adidas player of the game has got to be Larry English. Although Phil Horvath and Dan Nicholson have played well themselves. Cass Prime back in at tailback.
I'll tell you what, Phillip Simpson, number 94 for Temple, could play on my team any day of the week. He plays hard on every down. He's the young man who actually intercepted a pass dropping off in some sort of zone blitz package. And just, he made a catch that would be a nice grab for a back or a receiver.
Jim, what is, other than the obvious, I mean, fundraising and making sure you hire the right coaches, what do you think your most visible part of your job is day to day as the athletic director at Northern? What's the most important thing you do every day?
Well, I think it's to be around those student athletes and to make sure that they know and feel that they're being supported in their academic aspirations as well as their athletic endeavors. And, you know, that to me is really the impetus behind everything that we try and do. Certainly try and be a vocal and a contributor to the entire campus, sitting on the president's cabinet and trying to help us make good decisions for the future of Northern Illinois University, regardless of the athletics component of it. So I think there's, you know, you wear multiple hats, and certainly there's not enough hours in the day to get around to all the constituents that you really need to touch, but you try and be strategic in how you move around and try and touch all bases.
And you're making steady progress with the building as well.
Phenomenal facility that'll be open in the summer, and just a state-of-the-art academic and athletic performance center.
Huskies running the football, running it effectively here as the clock drips toward the 5.5-minute mark. You'll have some of the top boosters, some people from the community over at your home later, and you like to do that a lot after home football games.
I do. It's just a way to tell them thank you. Thank you for what you're doing for our student athletes and our program. And we do it after every home football game. My wife, Laura, is a saint to do that. And,
she is.
We'll have a couple hundred people over there tonight. I really love, we've had all the student athletes over. Last Thursday was the last dinner we've had, but we've had all 486 wow. student athletes over from August through now. It took us about 2 months, but every night we have usually one team or two teams come over, and it's been great, because I love that. I love that.
Who does the cooking?
Who get that catered in? Thank goodness.
Jim's vice president of catering as well.
Mrs. Phillips, we need you to cook for 480 today.
Yeah. But it's great, because what you see them is out of uniform, without a helmet on or without a basketball uniform on or jersey, and you come over, and some of these kids are from far distances, and their families aren't close that they can see them on a weekly basis. So it's a chance for Laura and I just to open up our house and just tell them how proud of them we are and to thank them for what they're doing. It gets them out of the dorm one night, gets them out of the apartment, and it's usually a really pretty good meal.
Have you had Victor over?
Yeah, Victor's been over.
I was remarking
Tom
earlier about
how
he looks
beefy.
Like he's a little pudgy. Maybe he's come over a little too much.
And the Huskies on first down pick up 8 here as the clock ticks toward the 4-minute mark. Jim, thanks for taking time all year long and for having us here. We love doing the games.
Appreciate it, guys, and we love the relationship with Comcast Sportsnet.
It's been fantastic.
You guys are the varsity. I mean that. I got a lot of respect for what you do, and we love having you come every year, so thank you.
You're the man.
Thanks, Jim.
Jim Phillips, the fine athletic director at Northern Illinois University. Huskies up 43-21. We're under 4 minutes to go.
Dan Nicholson doing a great job milking the clock at this time.
Just trying to move the chains. That's Cass Prime carrying the football. Tommy, this is our last game together this season. Been a pleasure working with you. Of course, I see you every day doing the radio, but a lot of fun calling college football through all season long.
And they have been such great hosts here at Northern Illinois.
Thank you to Donna Turner, our guy Mike Corsick, who just retired, and everybody.
And all of the visiting teams from the MAC. They've been a joy to work with, their SIDs. Benji in the truck is trying at times, but
everybody down in the truck has been just tremendous. I mean, we really are very fortunate. We have a tremendous crew of people here.
It's not easy to carry us.
It is not.
Through a three-hour broadcast.
But Todd Ben Jameson does a fabulous job as our producer. How would you like that job?
I'm afraid of heights.
Let's go down to Mark Scafidi on the sideline. Mark.
Hey, thanks, guys. Now, you might have noticed on the helmets a GW. Now, it doesn't stand for Garrett Wolf. It stands for Dr. George Wilkins, who is a friend of the program. Now, Dr. George passed away last year at the Northwestern game, and this year the team wanted to honor him with the support for Northern by putting his decal on the back of their helmets for the entire season. Back up to you guys.
All right, thank you, Mark. Take a look. There it is, the GW. George, a huge benefactor to the program. I believe his daughter teaches at Northern Illinois. He did not go to school here, but was so impressed with how things are run, walked in, said, I'd like to join the Booster Club, cultivated a relationship with Jim Phillips.
And I was going to say, I'm sure that's a decision that Jim Phillips made. He's a first-class athletic director, president, and vice president. All his other titles. He does a fabulous job here. I joke with him. I kid because I care.
Right. Those you care about, you can kid with.
That's right.
Third and 8. Clock under 1:45 now to go in DeKalb.
Guess who? It's been Larry English for the Huskies. It's been Phillip Simpson for the Owls.
And it will be a fourth down as the clock will tick. Timeout, Temple. We'll take the break with them. Waiting stages. Huskies going to win. Buck 37 to go in DeKalb on homecoming Saturday.
You know, there are some things families just don't like to share.
They don't want to share this.
Or this.
Or these.
Or this.
That's why with U.S. Cellular's family plan, everyone in the family gets their own phone. Plus, they can talk to each other free.
Speaking of which, does anyone want to talk about these?
Oh, those are Dwayne's!
See, you thought you lost them.
U.S. Cellular, we connect with you. Right now, get up to 4 free phones when you buy one for only $29.95.
Stop on in. We've got what you need. Stop on in. You're on the run.
At Casey's, we don't do thin and skimpy pizzas. Casey's piles them up real heavy. All month, get free cheese breadsticks with the purchase of any large pizza. Come in now and enter to win the Snickers Casey's Super Bowl Celebration Sweepstakes. You and a friend could end up at Super Bowl 41 in Miami.
Stop on in to Casey's General Store.
.137 left. The Huskies will win this football game. Still a nice smattering of fans here. Northern Illinois 4-3, 3-2 in the MAC. Temple will fall to 0-8. They officially joined the conference in 07. And the field goal attempt is no good. But the Huskies will improve to 5-3. They are 4-3, as I said. 3-2 in the MAC, so tack a victory on for him. A non-conference win over the
that
Temple.
That is correct, because Temple will not become a member of the MAC officially until 2007.
Right, I said that, but you weren't listening to me, buddy.
Busy day for Chris Nendick. 7 field goal attempts today, 5 of them good, 2 of them not good.
At Iowa next week, big party coming from the folks at Fatty's Pub and Grill. You can tailgate with them outside Kinnick Stadium. They always take good care of our crew. In fact, I think Todd Benjaminson, our fine producer,
He's actually the caricature for the place.
That's correct. Yeah. That's exactly right. They took a drawing of him.
Right.
And he's an Iowa grad, and I think he will be out there at Kinnick Stadium next week. He will be out there cheering on a good game, he says. And we are at the 1 minute mark.
Ken West forces him out of bounds. It's an Owls first down.
Tell you what, DeMichael has shown me some toughness today.
He has.
He really has.
They came after him all day long.
An onslaught early, and he hung in there. Real nice open field tackle. Really solid tackle by John Tranchitella, who's a linebacker, a freshman out of Addison, Illinois. Western suburb.
And you may be wondering why, with a 22-point deficit, the Temple Owls are still getting after it. A, because they're all competitors, and B, because, again, in Al Golden's first year, they're learning from every experience, whether it's the opening snap or it's trailing by 22 and working the two-minute offense at the end of the game. They can grow from each and every play, and I give them a lot of credit. It was not their best effort. They have made some, was not their best outing. They've made some mistakes, but their effort, you cannot question the effort of the Temple football team.
No, I talked to Al Golden Thursday morning, and he said that they were looking at this game after a bye as being the start of the 07 season. And they wanted to just continue to get better for conference play next year. I thought that was an interesting way to look at things.
Yeah. And he knew this was going to be a step up in class for him. Joe Novak has put together a fantastic program, coming off a difficult loss at Western Michigan last week. But this is a very solid Husky football team again this year. As we've said a number of times, Coach Novak looking for his seventh consecutive winning season here in DeKalb. Quite an accomplishment.
Yep. And, you know, as you said earlier, just look no farther than what Joe Novak was able to do with some support from the administration to ride out some tough times with the promise of better times down the road, and that's exactly what he's done.
Yeah. Well, I've been very impressed also today with Travis Shelton, number 22 in the Temple uniform. Has to be closing in on 200 yards receiving today. Did you see Coach Joe Novak? Proud of his defense today. That should put Shelton over 200 yards receiving today.
That's a big, big day.
But despite his gaudy numbers, Joe Novak's defense came out and played a whale of a football game for the majority of the afternoon.
There's a look at Joe Novak, and this may be the final play of the day. Pass is caught. And a timeout.
Travis Shelton, 7 catches, 204 yards receiving today. Came into this ball game, certainly, as maybe one of two or three of DeMichael's favorite receivers. I think now it's safe to say that he is
his favorite target.
Adam DeMichael's favorite target.
.6 seconds left, so this will be the final play of the game. But I like what I'm seeing. The Temple continues to battle.
I
think that's very impressive.
I told you, it's an opportunity. Each and every play is an opportunity for them to get better and to learn. And they're going to take each snap and try to teach with it and try to accomplish something with it.
The band waiting down in the south end zone. In the corner, they will take the field and
play.
That's
the first, I think that was actually a half smile from Joe. Joe's a very pleasant man, don't get me wrong.
The best, but he doesn't
show a
lot of emotion.
But when he's on the field during game time, he's not someone that's going to show a ton of emotion.
G- again, a huge thanks to everyone here in DeKalb and the Temple people. Their great SID and their football office to help us with everything. And thank you to our great crew from Comcast SportsNet. DeMichael running. And he will throw it back toward the end zone, and it will be intercepted. Picked off, fitting way to end the game. Melvin Rice grabs the pick, and Northern wins it 43-21. The final here on a homecoming Saturday. We will take a quick timeout. We'll come back with the Casey's post-game show. Right after this, stick around on Comcast SportsNet.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for attending today's game. We will see you again.
Advance your career with an MBA from Northern Illinois University.
I was able to balance my MBA with my professional life as well as my personal life. And best of all, NIU's MBA program is AACSB accredited and affordable.
I was impressed with the knowledge and experience of the professors, and the program provided me with a well-rounded business education. The affordability and convenient locations made my decision easy, and it made my MBA a reality.
Designed for the working professional, the MBA program at Northern Illinois University. Jumpstart your career today.
This broadcast of Northern Illinois Husky football on Comcast SportsNet is brought to you by U.S. Cellular, we connect with you. Fatty's Bar and Grill, the official tailgate home of NIU Athletics. Village Commons Bookstore, for all your Husky clothing and souvenirs, visit vcbs.com. Applebee's, try Applebee's car side to go. You call it in, we bring it out. Casey's General Stores, the official convenience store of NIU Athletics. Casey's, a convenience store and a whole lot more. Blaine's Farm and Fleet, I found it at Farm and Fleet. The NIU MBA programs, take the NIU MBA Challenge. The NIU Alumni Association, stay connected with NIU. And Kishwaukee Hospital.
So the Huskies win it here today, a non-conference tilt against an opponent they will see as a conference member next year. This is the Casey's General Store post-game show. Northern Illinois 43 and Temple 21. And Tommy, they didn't run the ball effectively today, but they certainly threw the ball well, the Huskies.
Yeah, a bit of an unconventional effort today. Normally, this Husky team is a run first, throw second offense. Today, Garrett Wolf just 45 yards on 17 carries, but Horvath and Nicholson combined for 377 yards passing and four touchdowns. So a win is a win is a win, regardless of how it looks. And defensively, boy, the Huskies got after Adam DeMichael out there, shut down the Temple running game, and created some turnovers. Just a great complete effort from the Huskies.
You're right. They really did win the battle of the trenches on the defensive side, maybe not on the offensive side. And that means that Sam Pittman and the offensive line crew will go back to work.
Well, there's no doubt. Every team that comes to DeKalb, their first goal defensively is to slow down Garrett Wolf. And teams now for the second straight week have been able to do that. But when you see seven and eight guys at the line of scrimmage trying to defend the run, they're daring you to throw the football. Well, today, Phil Horvath called their bluff, and he actually executed. He himself threw for 253 and two scores and bounced back from a very difficult afternoon last week at Western Michigan, where, as we talked earlier, he threw three picks in his first 10 throws. So a nice effort from Horvath, a nice effort from this defense as well.
Tommy, as you look at today's game, our Adidas player of the game has got to be number 51,
English. Don't think there's any doubt. Larry English with 4.5 sacks. He recovered a fumble.
And forced one.
And forces the fumble as well. So he was in the backfield all afternoon. I believe Adam DeMichael is going to have visions of Larry English running through his nightmares for some time to come. But it's something that the Huskies needed to see. They came into this football game with just 12 total sacks through seven games. Larry English comes up with 4.5 of his own today.
So it's a happy bunch of Huskies as they win it 43-21 for our great crew, for Tom Waddle, for Mark Scafidi. Thanks so much, folks. We want to thank you for joining us all season long at Comcast SportsNet. We had a great time. We hope you enjoyed our broadcast. For Tommy and Mark, I'm David Kaplan saying so long from Husky Stadium in DeKalb. 43-21, your final. The preceding has been an exclusive presentation of Comcast SportsNet. and the Huskies of Northern Illinois University. Have a great evening, everybody.
The incredibly delicious Arby's Market Fresh Turkey Ranch and Bacon Sandwich or Wrap. Loaded with roast turkey, creamy ranch spread, cheddar cheese, and thick-cut pepper bacon. It's so good, it'll have you saying, "I'm thinking Arby's."
Saturn?
That's a Saturn.
That's a Saturn.
Saturn?
Wow. Saturn?
That's a Saturn?
That's not a Saturn.
That's a Saturn?
That's a Saturn.
Now, every 2007 Saturn vehicle comes standard with the best coverage in America, including the GM 100,000-mile warranty.
Wouldn't it be great if you never had to clean your gutters again? Get a no-clog gutter system from Empire today. Our unique seamless design prevents leaves and debris from ever getting into your gutters. You'll never have clogged gutters again, guaranteed, or we'll clean them for you free. Save with manufacturer direct prices, plus make no payments till 2008. So get your mind out of the gutter. Call Empire today.
800-588-2300-EMPIRE.
Today. The incredibly delicious Arby's Market Fresh Turkey Ranch and Bacon Sandwich or Wrap. Loaded with roast turkey, creamy ranch spread, cheddar cheese, and thick-cut pepper bacon. It's so good, it'll have you saying, "I'm thinking Arby's."
These two teams have been playing each other twice a year since 1960.
If there's bad blood in one game, it's going to fester next time, and the next year, and then the next time next year.
Clear as day that he ripped the helmet right off.
This is the reason why you hate him. This is what we're going to do. We're going to bury you.
No matter what the records are, that game's going to be intense, and it's going to come down to the wire.
It's the teams you love, the rivals you hate, and the stories you'll never forget. Told from a different perspective, through the camera lens. Highlighting the artistry of the still photograph, FSN lets the witnesses to history tell the tales and bring the drama in focus.
When the schedule came out, you looked at when the Chiefs were going to play the Raiders, 6 months in advance.
To me, it's black holes and fans and screaming coaches.
It looks like the end of the world by the time the kickoff starts. There are guys dressed with makeup and spikes, and you can always count on an extra squad car or two to be in the parking lot to clean up the mess afterward.
It's Raider week, and that's different than any week in the season. If you win Raider week, you're doing all right.
When I first came to Oakland, I didn't really understand the rivalry. It's something that drives so much emotion through you because you just want to shut these people up.
It's serious hatred. From the time you land, time you get off the bus and go to your hotel room, it is a nasty thing. And those people in the Midwest in Kansas City, they're nice people. Except for one time a year, that's when the Raiders come to town.
Their battles are legendary, bred of jealousy and contempt and nurtured into full-blown hatred. The Oakland Raiders and the Kansas City Chiefs have waged wildcat war for over 40 years.
Well, the rivalry started in the AFL. It's rooted as deep as it can be with that.
The AFL were these eight franchises, mostly frustrated owners who couldn't get into the NFL. The Raiders were kind of a late add-on, and they were a doormat in the early years of the AFL when the Chiefs were in Dallas as the Dallas Texans. And the Chiefs moved to Kansas City about the time an assistant coach named Al Davis took command of the Oakland Raiders.
General manager and head coach Al Davis epitomized the Raider mystique.
He was a hustler from Brooklyn. If Al Davis came along today, he would star in The Sopranos. I mean, he was that kind of guy. Watch your back. Al Davis is around.
He has this image in Kansas City that's probably mythical. Darth Vader-like, creepy guy that wears silver and black jumpsuits. And for years, there was talk that he would put bounties on Chiefs players so that his Oakland guys would go get him in a game.
Davis didn't care how you played the game as long as you win. The famous mantra, just win, baby.
I think the way he sort of inflamed the rivalry is the way he treated the people that were on the opposing sideline. There was a reason why, somewhere down the line, somewhere in history, why these people derived such a hate for the Oakland Raiders.
If Al Davis wore the black hat, Chiefs owner Lamar Hunt sported the white.
Lamar Hunt is congenial. He's classy. He is one of the originals. When you meet him, you feel like you're in the presence of some great president.
If you look at those two organizations, they're so diametrically opposed. You've got the Chiefs, who are the most collegiate of the NFL organizations.
They couldn't have facial hair. They wore ties. And the Raiders pretty much, they were the rebels. They did and dressed and looked the way they wanted.
But they became the two best teams out of that league. The Raiders built their team to beat the Chiefs. Al Davis had this mantra that in order to get to the championship game, you have to build your team to win the division.
It was all pretty simple. Whoever won the Western Division was going to probably win the AFL.
From 1966 to 1969, the Raiders dominated the Chiefs, winning six out of eight games. But in the 1969 AFL Championship game, the Chiefs had their chance for revenge.
Back to throw, LaMonica, he is sacked. Did he get creamed by Aaron Brown?
Led by MVP quarterback Daryl LaMonica, the Raiders had won both regular season games and were favored to advance to the Super Bowl.
The great thing about that game was that the Raiders came to the stadium with their bags packed to go to New Orleans. And the Chiefs found out about it before the game.
The Chiefs saw those bags packed, and they were incensed. The Raiders were already making their plans for New Orleans. They hadn't played the game yet.
They fully expected to win, you know, and they should have expected to win because they kind of owned the Chiefs. The Chiefs only beat them once between 67 and 69.
With a stifling defense led by Aaron Brown and Emmett Thomas, the Chiefs shut down the Raiders' highly touted offense.
Monica will throw one deep for Warren Wells. It's intercepted by 20 by Emmett Thomas.
Winning the game 17-7.
The Chiefs took it to them, and the Chiefs won the AFL championship.
When they were leaving, all the Raiders, they had all their suitcases. They had to take them back home after the game.
The inspired Chiefs would go on to beat the Vikings 23-7 in Super Bowl IV.
And that AFL championship was basically the last AFL game ever played. And then the merger took effect the following year. That's really where some bad blood first began.
Davidson comes in after Dawson is down, spears him in the back.
Wasn't it beautiful?
I have genital herpes. And I try to be careful.
Then my doctor told me something surprising.
One study found that up to 70% of people who had genital herpes got it from their partner when they had no signs or symptoms of an outbreak.
And it doesn't matter how few outbreaks you get. You may still spread herpes at any time.
Now I take once daily Valtrex to reduce my risk of passing it on.
Valtrex is the only medicine proven
to reduce the risk of spreading genital herpes.
Always use safer sex practices with daily therapy, which also includes avoiding sexual contact when you get or think you're getting an outbreak. There's no cure for herpes. Even with treatment, it's possible to spread herpes. Valtrex is for adults with healthy immune systems. To avoid a potentially serious complication, tell your doctor if your immune system isn't normal because of bone marrow or kidney transplant or advanced HIV disease.
Ask your doctor about once daily Valtrex.
Now I'm doing even more to reduce the risk of spreading genital herpes, and I feel good about that.
Now save up to $10 on each prescription at Valtrex.com.
Homeowners, want to get cash and simplify your bills? Ask about a combo loan from Countrywide. It's a refi that you could use to combine your first mortgage, your second mortgage, your car loan, and all your high-rate credit card debt into one easy loan with one low monthly payment. It could save you hundreds every month. Call America's number one home loan lender now and ask for a combo loan. No one can do what Countrywide can. Apply now.
Call 1-800-641-9735.
Remember last week when you hit Vinny in the head with the shovel?
I do not recall that.
It was too graphic for the kids, so I'm going to have to block you.
You know, I got to make this
That's
up.
That's really not necessary.
This is Vinny's watch.
Last season, the Bulls took the champs to the brink, displaying tremendous heart along the way. Now, a new era dawns on the West Side as new faces joined an established core to serve notice they've arrived. Ben Wallace and the Bulls are primed to make a run at the NBA championship. 47 big matchups, every home game in high definition, the best pre- and post-game shows, and Stacey King joins Tom and Johnny on the call. Bulls basketball, Tuesday night on Comcast Sportsnet. Nobody does Bulls better.
When the AFL merged into the NFL in 1970, both the Oakland Raiders and Kansas City Chiefs were placed in the AFC West. There, they would continue to battle twice a year. With more at stake than ever, hostilities intensified.
Guys that had only played for the Chiefs, they hate the Raiders. That's what they were taught, and I'm sure it was the same way with the Raiders.
It wasn't unusual for the Chiefs and Raiders to have fisticuffs all through the year.
Tempers worsened with each fiery meeting. With two hard-nosed defenses squaring off, it was only a matter of time before it turned violent.
Ben Davidson for the Raiders and Buck Buchanan for the Chiefs. No other teams in the NFL had guys like these two guys. They were so big and strong and dominant as far as jamming up the line and rushing the passer.
They would beat each other up and try everything under the sun to gain an advantage. And a lot of those advantages were late hits. Wasn't it beautiful?
The eruption finally occurred in their first meeting of the 1970 season. At 3-3, the Chiefs were desperate. They needed a win at home to give them any chance at the conference crown.
The winner of the game was going to be in first place. The loser was going to drop out. This was about midway through the season.
The Chiefs are leading the Raiders by three, have the ball in the final minutes.
The Chiefs needed a first down to run out the clock, and Lenny Dawson ran a bootleg.
Len Dawson scrambles for a 19-yard gain, which would have sewed up the game because the Raiders are out of timeouts.
Right at the end of the play, Davidson comes in after Dawson is down, spears him in the back.
And before a flag could even be thrown, if a flag was going to be thrown, here comes Otis Taylor protecting his quarterback, and he went after Ben Davidson. They got into a fight.
Nobody was going to do that to the Chiefs quarterback, especially Ben Davidson of the Raiders.
Otis Taylor took exception to the spearing his quarterback when he was on the ground and came and got me around the head. We ended up in a big pile, and actually I was in the safest place on the field. I was buried under a pile of Chiefs.
The officials huddled for a long, 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 long time. Had no idea what to call on. I think they were really lost.
Today that would have been one of those post-possession fouls. Well, they flagged Davidson for the spear, Taylor for unsportsmanlike conduct, offsetting penalties, so the Chiefs, who had that third and 19, had to replay the down. They didn't convert that third down, so they had a punt.
And George Blanda kicked a long field goal. We tied the game.
And there was no overtime back then in the regular season, so the game finished in a tie, and the Raiders won the AFC West by that one game.
That seemed to be my defining moment in the NFL, is jumping on Lenny Dawson. And I guess it's not a great thing to be remembered for, but on the other hand, it's great to be remembered.
Coming up next, a legend switches sides.
When you're that good a player, you should get a pass.
The last place you'd expect Marcus Allen to play would be for the Chiefs.
If you could build your own Nissan Altima, what would it have? We thought so. The Nissan Altima Special Edition Package. 14 popular options and a $199 per month lease at your Nissan dealer now. Nissan Altima. We built it just for you.
From 1974 to 1988, the Raiders beat the Chiefs 20 of 29 times. Led by Hall of Famers Fred Biletnikoff, Jim Otto, and Willie Brown, the Raiders won Super Bowls in 1977 and 1981. Marcus Allen would lead them to a third Super Bowl title in 1984. Envious of the Raiders' success, Chiefs owner Lamar Hunt went in search of a head coach. He wanted a man who would not just beat the Raiders, he wanted someone who hated them.
When Marty Schottenheimer and Carl Peterson took over the Chiefs in 1989, Marty turned Raiders Week into his own personal hell week, and he let the Chiefs players know that we don't respect the Raiders for the way they do business. They are out there on a limb. They don't put the league first. They put the Raiders first.
Marty likes to whack the Raiders. He doesn't like to beat them. He likes to whack them.
In his first four seasons at the helm, Schottenheimer posted a solid 6-2 record against the Raiders.
He owned the Raiders. When they played the Raiders, they won. He just beat them year after year after year. He beat them in Kansas City. He beat them in L.A. and Oakland. He had their number.
It was funny to me. It was unusual to me because you had never seen, or you hardly seen on the professional level, someone so passionate about disliking another team or another organization. But that's how Marty Schottenheimer was. And we knew that we were going to have our hands full.
That's a guy that got it. He understood that it was important to beat the Raiders. And he'd go in that locker room and say to those players, it's Raiders week. We're going to get those guys.
Marty Schottenheimer may have turned the tide, but it was a stunning Raider defection that changed the rivalry forever. Running back Marcus Allen was the pride of Raider Nation. He rushed for over 4,000 yards and 40 touchdowns in his first four seasons and was named MVP of Super Bowl XVII. By 1992, however, Al Davis had relegated his most famous player to the bench.
The prevailing theory and the most logical theory is that Marcus became the face of the Raiders in Los Angeles, and he was the most popular athlete, and Al was no longer the face of the Raiders. It was Marcus.
Al Davis doesn't covet stars. You know, he likes great players, but he doesn't like anybody to be bigger than the team.
Apparently, Al Davis decided Marcus Allen was done, stuck him on the bench, and didn't want him anymore.
People just could not understand how you could freeze out a potential Hall of Fame and an ultimate Hall of Fame player like Marcus Allen.
I mean, he won the Super Bowl with one of the most memorable runs you'll ever see in Super Bowl history. Super Bowl heroes should be treated differently. When you're that good a player, you should get a pass. You should be treated with a little bit more deference than Al Davis treated Marcus Allen.
In 1987, Al Davis drafted two sports star Bo Jackson to step in as the Raiders' starting halfback.
This is Al Davis's kind of football player. Al Davis loves size, and he loves speed. Well, Bo Jackson, I mean, my God, it was like the Terminator, you know, coming in as a halfback. But when he came in, it was kind of the end for Marcus Allen.
The interesting thing was, this was 1993, first year of free agency in the NFL.
The Chiefs decided to take advantage of the league's new free agent landscape. They had already traded for quarterback Joe Montana to run their new West Coast offense. And after the 92 season, when Marcus Allen's contract with the Raiders expired, the Chiefs signed him to a three-year deal.
Marty Schottenheimer hates the Raiders. And for them to sign Marcus, for Marcus to come on board and play so well, especially against the Raiders, was a thumb in the eye of Al Davis.
When Marcus Allen came to Kansas City, I thought, well, you know, maybe he is past his prime. I watched him one game, I was like, why isn't he still in a Raider uniform?
Marcus Allen over the top, ties the record.
Touchdown, Kansas City.
They used him so effectively. They took advantage of his strengths.
Allen proved his worth. In Kansas City, he would pass the 10,000-yard and 100 career TD marks, always saving his best performances for the team that had discarded him.
Marcus Allen had to look at every opportunity to play the Raiders as payback time. Just payback's a bitch. And I'm going to go in and get Al Davis and show him I had no business on the bench.
Every time they played the Raiders, I think he looked forward to it because he had a bad taste in his mouth about the way he was treated there. He wanted to prove that, hey, he let something good get away.
I think everybody involved realized from the Oakland side that was probably a mistake to let him go, or at least let him go to Kansas City. In his perfect world, it would have all worked out in Oakland with the Raiders, but it wasn't a perfect world. If he had to go anywhere, I think this was as good a place any for him because he could play against them a couple times a year and maybe rub their noses in it.
Coming up next, an eye for an eye.
As Elvis put in, it was a real slap in the face. Slap in the face to Rich. We always had a chip on his shoulder. He always felt like he was unappreciated.
Dad, it's the Army Reserve.
It's the Army.
No. I can still go to college.
It's the Army.
I'm going to be part of something that's important. And it's the Reserve, so they'll train me around here until they need me.
Good training?
It's the Army.
As a soldier in the United States Army Reserve, you can strengthen yourself, your family, and your country. Pursue a civilian career. Continue your education. With the Army Reserve, you'll train near home and serve when needed. and you'll have over 120 careers to choose from, including working with some of the most sophisticated technology in the world. Call 1-888-844-ARMY now for a free DVD and hear from soldiers who have already answered the call. You'll also get a free sports watch. Stand ready in the Army Reserve.
Brothers and sisters,
parents and coaches,
we have found a home
where over 20,000 of our beloved nation can gather in mass support.
Bridgeview's brand new Toyota Punch.
The fire rules supreme.
There is an air of excellence in this new stadium. We have enjoyed the spoils of victory, and we will rise again.
Come out and experience Chicago Fire Playoffs at Toyota Park on Sunday, October 22nd at noon.
Generation Red, now's the time.
With a newly energized offense, the Chiefs dominated the Raiders through the 1990s. But in 1996, quarterbacked by Montana's replacement Steve Bono, the Chiefs finished a disappointing 9-7 and failed to make the playoffs for the first time in 7 years. Instead of turning the reins over to beloved backup Rich Gannon, the Chiefs acquired young 49ers quarterback Elvis Gerbach as their long-term solution.
In 96, Bono was having some problems, and Rich was your typical backup quarterback. He was always, in the fans' eyes, you know, the people's choice.
Rich Gannon was really overlooked here. They just didn't take him seriously as a starting quarterback. Every guy on the Chiefs loved Rich Gannon, and they wanted him to be their quarterback. And for some reason, the Chiefs organization, they kind of missed the boat on him.
And that's when the Chiefs signed Elvis Gerbach to a big free agent contract in 1997, figuring Gannon was pigeonholed as the relief pitcher.
The Chiefs decide, well, we like you, Rich, but we like Elvis Gerbach a lot more, so he's going to be our guy.
So Gerbach in 97 gets him off to a great start. They're like 9-1 when he hurt his shoulder, and Gannon came in, held the fort. The Chiefs went 13-3. Gerbach had missed 4 or 5 games during that 13-3 run, and the Chiefs made the decision to bring Gerbach back for the playoff game against the Denver Broncos.
Down 14-10 to Denver with 4:04 to go, Gerbach attempted to inspire a drive into the winning seconds. When his goal line pass fell incomplete, so did the Chiefs' playoff hopes. Chiefs fans were left wondering if Gannon might have fared better.
Every man in that locker room wanted Rich Gannon to be quarterback. And to have Elvis put in was a real slap in the face to Rich. He was never respected as a player. And so he always had a chip on his shoulder. He always felt like he was unappreciated.
In February of 1999, Al Davis and newly appointed head coach John Gruden courted Gannon and signed him to a 4-year, $16 million contract. Gannon made an immediate impact on his new teammates.
The one thing he impressed upon the Raiders was, they hate us. They say we're gonna quit, and let's show these guys we're not gonna be quitters.
Rich Gannon told a great story. The first year after he played for the Raiders, Marty Schottenheimer used to paint the picture of what the Raiders were like. For so many years, and you just had it in your head, you were brainwashed that this place was evil, and it was insane, and no one in the right mind would ever want to play here. And you come here, it's just like any other place.
He comes to the Raiders, and he's finally home.
When John Gruden brought Rich Gannon to the Oakland Raiders, he made him the starter from day one. You aren't backing up anybody, you're here to be the starter. And I think Rich took that as a personal challenge for him to go out there and play his absolute best football.
Gannon got immediate revenge in January of 2000. The Raiders visited Kansas City in the final game of the regular season. The Chiefs sat at 9-6. A win meant a playoff berth. A loss by the Chiefs, and their season was over.
There's so many ramifications that are riding on this game, not only for us in the building momentum and gaining confidence, but for this Kansas City team. They've got to win to get in the playoffs. Now the heated rivalry is on. Everyone assumes that they're going to win.
The Chiefs jumped out to a huge lead, and we were like, wow, the Chiefs can be in the playoffs.
It was 17-0. The Raiders blocked a punt to make it 17-7. And you know how sometimes those things can change the course of a game.
I think once we tied it up is when they began to realize, oh, it's not going to be an easy game. And by that time, it was too late.
After mounting a monumental comeback, Chiefs kicker Pete Stoyanovich missed a game-winning 44-yard field goal at the end of regulation. The game now into overtime.
We had sucked all the momentum out of the stadium. They weren't making as much noise as we were. I remember Rich coming in a huddle one time and saying, you know what, we got them. We got them pinned up against the wall. Now let's break their backs. Let's shut this crowd up and go home victorious. And that's what happened.
It was a big win for the Raiders. They kind of stuck it to the Chiefs, and they kept the Chiefs out of the playoffs that year.
It was bad enough to lose that game, no matter who they were playing. And then to lose it to a team that they always beat, to a hated rival, it was just another twist of the knife. This rivalry, particularly in recent years, has been filled with games like that.
In 2002, Gannon led the Raiders back to the Super Bowl. They lost to Tampa Bay, but Gannon was named league MVP.
Rich Gannon won the MVP award by dominating Kansas City the year he won that award.
There were times that Rich took games in his own hands and won games for our football team. And that's what you expect from your quarterback. That's what you ask for your quarterback. Rich finishing his career in Oakland made him a legend.
With every new fall in the NFL comes new hope, new faces, new contenders, and new struggles to face on the road to the Super Bowl. But one thing will always remain a constant. Two times a year, 40 years of pent-up hostility and jealousy and contempt will pour out onto the field for 60 minutes of KC Oakland mayhem.
It's always been heated, and it's always two games that you look forward to every single season.
No matter what the records are, no matter how big the game is, no matter who's in first place, there's just always something that satisfies, like beating the Raiders. Maybe to people on the outside who aren't paying a lot of attention, they might say, well, you know what, this rivalry isn't what it used to be. But to those players on the field, I guarantee it is.
I'm Mark Schanowski. Monday on Chicago Tribune Live, we'll recap week 7 in the NFL and look ahead to next Sunday's Bears game against San Francisco. That, plus the latest from the World Series, starts Monday at 5:30.
Welcome to Fantasy Fix, everyone. We are approaching the halfway mark of the season. We hope you are smoking. A guy who's smoking every single week is our man, John Hansen from FantasyGuru.com. As we reach about the halfway mark, you're in like 55 leagues, a lot of them expert leagues. I want you to be honest. How are you doing? How are you faring?
Doing pretty well. It's been a pretty good year. My record on average is about 4-2, so I should probably make the playoffs. I have a few teams that'll probably be one and done in the playoffs. Maybe half of my teams will be serious contenders to win it all.
You know, I always wonder, how does your wife put up with you? You're doing nothing but fantasy football week in and week out. What kind of life do you live? It's terrible, isn't
it? Well, she hasn't worked since 1992, so she doesn't really complain too much about fantasy football.
By the way, are you a Scorpio? No, I'm just kidding. Enough of this. Let's get to work, shall we?
Do it.
Enough of getting to know John Hansen this week. Besides, we see enough of him as it is. We want to know who's going to be hot this week. It's our Fixer Upper segment. John, as always, we start with quarterbacks, and there is a new name at the top of the list, and anyone who saw the Monday night game last week against Chicago said a star is born in Matt Leinart.
I think Matt Leinart is rock solid now. I don't think he has much upside down the road this week. Not a great matchup against the Raiders. The Raiders can actually stop the pass, but Leinart will be out for blood because those Raiders passed him up in the draft. He'll show them they made a big mistake. Anquan Boldin gets a touchdown, probably Brian Johnson too.
And the hottest quarterback in football these days, Jake Delhomme. A lot has to do with Steve Smith, but again, ride Jake Delhomme when he's got those receivers.
Very streaky player, very excellent receiver in Steve Smith. Keyshawn, how about Drew Carter making big plays? A great matchup overall. They're going to run the football very well. They're going to have a lot of balance. They're going to pick their spots with Smith and Keyshawn. Good game for Jake.
All right, John Kitna playing at the Jets and Byron Leftwich against Houston. We know that. Again, second page, another young guy, Phillip Rivers, again, who seems to be getting better and better each week on a very good team.
I trust Phillip Rivers already, and it's kind of amazing that Marty Schottenheimer's kind of taking the shackles off quickly here in week seven. Week five, it really started. Throwing the football very, very well. He doesn't have great mobility, but this guy's an elite passer.
Speaking of young quarterbacks, Bruce Gradkowski, only a couple of starts. Do you like him as a player or the matchup against the Eagles defense?
I like the matchup because the Eagle team is allowing the most offensive plays on the other side in the league. So Bruce Gradkowski is going to be on the field plenty. He's going to throw plenty. Eventually, he's probably going to get two touchdowns.
All right, Chad Pennington and Mark Brunell round out the list there of quarterbacks. Now we move on to the running backs here. And they're playing a lot of defense in Denver, but Tatum Bell starting to show some signs of waking up.
One more big game from Tatum Bell, and he's not going to make the program because there's going to be too obvious of a selection against the Browns. He's running hard again, hitting it up in there, pretty much doing everything Mike Shanahan wants him to do. He's the man. He'll go off 100 yards and a touch.
Yeah, Ronnie Brown, by the way, keeps you in the business another week because you said if he didn't have a big week this week, you were quitting the business. He had 127 yards. He did. So you like him again this week. How about Kevin Jones? Seems to be becoming that a guy they thought they had at the beginning of the season before he started fumbling.
I'm not actually that thrilled with Kevin Jones. I'll tell you this. If he faces a good defense in a big game, bench him because he's not going to do anything. If he has a good matchup, start him because he's going to go off. And this is a very good matchup against the Packers. They'll move the ball at home, set him up, and he'll probably score. Actually, he's on the road. But the Jets are really bad against the run. He'll score this week.
Okay, quickly, the Fred Taylor, Maurice Jones, Drew, either one. You start either one is the thinking there.
Well, Jack Del Rio's on the road coming off a bye. Doesn't want to play around with Houston because they can be dangerous, believe it or not, at home. So they're going to get out to a lead, and they're just going to run. I like both guys.
All right, we move on here to Sean Foster. That's an obvious one, we believe. Edgerrin James really struggling. Of course, last week with Chicago, that defense very good. Oakland's defense not so good.
I'll tell you what, if he gets 500 carries this year, he's going to rush for 1,000 yards.
You better
believe
it.
Okay, you mark that down, my friend. Seriously, the Raider defense, not too bad against the pass, getting weaker and weaker by the week against the run. Leinart will move the ball. James will actually have a good game.
All right, Dylan and Maroney, which one do you like better of the two?
I guess you got to go Dylan. He is the starter, but, you know, the Bills, again, they've had trouble stopping the run all year long. Last week, Kevin Jones did it. This week, these two do it again.
All right. You also have Lamont Jordan in a bounce back there from that key turnover he had last week. We go to the wide receivers now, and it's always an easy pick, you think, but it hasn't been like it's been in the past picking those Indianapolis wide receivers, but you do like Reggie Wayne.
Do like Reggie Wayne, and, you know, he's due. That's just riveting analysis, but seriously.
And it is against Washington secondary, which is beat up and not very good at the
Sean
ball.
Springs is probably going to play. Carlos Rogers, the number one pick, is out. That is why I like Reggie Wayne. He's going to have a big game.
And you don't like that Eagles secondary, apparently, with Joey Galloway, again, being thrown to by a rookie quarterback in Gradkowski.
Let's face it, they give up big plays in Philly. And like I said at the top, Bruce Gradkowski is going to be on the field a lot. He's going to attempt a lot of passes. Eventually, Joey Galloway will get it done.
All right, Chambers also on the list. Lee Evans, he's another guy that's going to fall off this because he's becoming money.
He doesn't get the touchdowns. Now, that's a problem. If you're in a point-per-reception league, he has been money big time. But, again, they're not going to run the football. Willis McGahee running hard. It's not happening with their running game. New England's got a great run defense. They're going to force J.P. Lossman to throw it. He's going to look for Lee Evans.
Former Mr. Money, now just loose change. Randy Moss makes your list. You got to tell me why. Is it just because it's Arizona?
It is Arizona. Now, Antoine Roll is a pretty good player, but it's in the black hole. I think they'll move the ball with Jordan, and that gives Moss a real good chance to get a cheapie.
All right, you see the rest of the list there. Now it's tight end time, and Jeremy Shockey, big game for the Giants down there in Dallas, and you think Shockey is big-time player against that Cowboy defense.
What a difference a week makes. I was down on Shockey last week because of the injury and the lackluster performances and things like that. Came up huge last week, had a terrific game. You know what? Roy Williams is a great safety. He is not all that in coverage. He's going to have trouble with Shockey.
All right, Randy McMichael and last year's man crush, Chris Cooley, again, inching his way back onto the list.
You can throw to the tight end against the cover two, the Tampa two that they run in Indianapolis, and I think they're going to take Clinton Portis out of the game, and Burnell's going to have to chuck it up there a lot.
Still got the man crush, by the way, on him?
I'm not feeling it so far.
Not this
not
year.
Happening.
Okay, we move on to the second list. You see Ben Watson, Alex Smith, Chris Baker, Jason Witten. What's the interesting
Chris
one here?
Chris Baker, if you need a tight end this week, Tim Uwis, I believe that's how you pronounce
Uwis,
it.
Yeah.
Uwis, the tight end for Buffalo. If you're giving up touchdowns to Tim Uwis, you've got issues against the tight end. Detroit, the worst team in football against the tight end. Chris Baker, good chance to score.
Could be a touchdown maker this week. All right, we're going to take a break here on Fantasy Fix. Coming up, we've got our studs, duds, and sleepers segment. Bob Cooney sitting in for Ed Barkowitz. But as we go to the break, check out some of this week's NFL matchups.
Haven't ordered dinner yet? Then try Giordano's, Chicago's famous stuffed pizza. We made it good. You made it famous.
Are you ready for new windows and siding? Just call Empire today. Our triple pane windows feature self-cleaning glass and a lifetime limited glass breakage warranty. Our vinyl siding is energy efficient and maintenance free. You can trust Empire today for professional installation in just 2 weeks. You'll save with warehouse direct prices, plus make no payments till 2008. So if you are thinking about new windows or siding, we're ready when you are. Call Empire today.
800-588-2300-EMPIRE.
Today.
It's often said that the best offense is a good defense. Makes sense. Protect your goal and give yourself a chance to win. Of course, you can't win without scoring. So for the select few who can play on both ends of the ice, the opposite is true as well. Because sometimes, the best defense is a good offense. Brent Seabrook is a Blackhawk and reliable.
Announcing Max Madsen's massive Mitsubishi markdown. Increased factory shipments require Max Madsen to mark down every new driven to thrill Mitsubishi model. Every new Galant, Eclipse, Endeavor, Spyder, Lancer, Outlander, Raider pickup, even Evo. Plus every pre-driven vehicle. 0% APR financing or cash back from $1,000 to $5,000 to qualified buyers. It's our biggest markdown in our 20-year history. Max Madsen's massive Mitsubishi markdown.
And welcome back to Fantasy Fix. You saw some more of the matchups this week in the NFL. We continue talking about players we love and players maybe we don't love so much. It is our studs, duds, and sleepers segment. And we bring in Bob Cooney from the Philadelphia Daily News, relieving Ed Barkowitz. He's covering the Philadelphia Flyers this week. You got the better gig, my friend.
He's covering the Flyers. He's last in our fantasy football league, so he needed to take a little bit of a break.
This may be more than just 1 week for you. We may have to keep you here.
I am in first place. So.
All right, studs, duds, and sleepers. I'm going to start this weekend. I mean, this guy is an all-time stud. Certainly could have been MVP last year and been hard to get any kind of argument. Steve Smith is back, and let's face it, he is a difference maker, not only for the Panthers, but for your fantasy football team. Not that you wouldn't play him anyway, but I just love him. Larry Johnson, since the neck injury, things have been a little shaky there. Plus, he's going up against the San Diego defense this week. Meanwhile, Kevin Jones taking on that Jets defense, which is 30th overall. They throw the ball a lot there, so I expect them a lot of receiving yards. So I like Kevin Jones. So, Bob, you take it away.
All right.
And, of course, we know John Kitna, but why this week?
Just because I just look at that Jets game. Jets give up a load of points. Yeah. Kevin Jones, as you mentioned, starting to come around a little bit. John talked about against bad teams. He really goes off, opens up the passing game for Kitna. I think he's going to have a pretty good week there. He's had a couple decent weeks his last 2 weeks, so I think it'll roll. I think it's going to be a really, really high-scoring game, that game there. My other guy, Warrick Dunn, he hasn't been real good the last few weeks. 55 yards, 44 yards. Had 149 this past week, but he had a 90-yard run.
Well,
take that
true.
Away, he was kind of getting shut down a little bit
sure
there.
Sure counts for points, though, in your fantasy league.
You're right. But I Pittsburgh defense, I mean, if there's a team that shuts down a number one running back, it's Pittsburgh. They've done it to Larry Johnson, Ronnie Brown, Fred Taylor, Rudy Johnson. They've done it to everybody. They've shut Ladainian Tomlinson down. I don't see this being a good week at all for Warrick Dunn. And then Matt Leinart, you guys kind of hit on earlier. People are I think a lot of people, the reason I put him as sleeper, are looking at him 2 more weeks down. All right, let's see how he does this week, next week, then maybe I'll think about him. And John hit on this also. I think this is a week that he might have another real good game with the changeup in the offense and stuff like that. I think he'll be okay.
All right, and we have not forgotten about you. Tatum Bell, you talked about at the top of the show that you liked, and Carson Palmer, Why not this week? What's going on there?
Oh, you know, big-time problems on the offensive line for Carson Palmer. Let's not forget he's coming off a serious knee injury. You know, he's great and all. He's the best pure passer in the NFL. But Levi Jones is out. He's been without a center, Rich Brohm. Chad Johnson, the deep passing game not really happening. I don't think he's really seeing things right now. I don't think he's playing with a lot of confidence. You couple the fact that he got the offensive line, you got a tough matchup against Carolina. Tough time for Carson Palmer.
You really love the Jets this week. You already mentioned Chris Baker and now Leon Washington. He's a guy who's largely unknown for a lot of people. Tell us about him.
Well, I like him. He's a third-round pick. He's got some game-breaking ability, and this Jet team is without playmakers. Let's face it, Laurinus Coles is a nice receiver, having a heck of a year, but Jericho Cotchery is not going to keep defensive coordinators up at night. They need playmakers. Leon Washington is. He's getting about 10 carries a game. Detroit's in bad shape. Now, Dan Cody's out, defensive tackle. Sean Rogers suspended. They're usually good against the run, but without those two guys, they're going to be weak. So I think Washington is a good sleeper.
You know, we've been talking about matchups here and putting players in good positions to win. Or do you just play your best players and that's it? Well, this week, Steve Zabin has an interesting take.
All righty, everybody. Steve Zabin here along with Scott Lynn. We are the first team on Fox coming to you from D.C., and we are late 30s, mm-hmm. fantasy football nerds.
Nerds.
And you, and Scott Lynn's beside himself this week because he sat Anquan Boldin, who went nuts against the Bears. Because you know what? Matchups are crap.
Overrated.
Okay? The most overrated thing in all of fantasy football. Here's a tip for everyone out there. Play your best guys whenever possible. The reason that matchups are such a vogue thing on shows like this, and even that we give out advice, it makes you sound smart as a fantasy football expert. Oh, he's got a tough matchup.
Yeah, greatest thing in the world, easiest thing in the world is to whip out a piece of newspaper and say, oh, statistically, great pass defense. Bears having a lot of pass touchdown all year, blah, 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 blah. Matt Leinart comes out, throws two in the first quarter.
Shreds them.
Good call, Scott. Way to go for leaving Anquan on the bench.
Certain guys are not done yet in fantasy, right?
Kevin Jones,
not done yet. He's starting to put up monster numbers. Roy Williams putting up monster numbers. Big Ben, not done yet.
Not done yet. Derek Mason's 0-for, though, this past Sunday. Inexplicable. I don't understand. I know that there were a couple of balls that were tipped by Bowler or Bowler's balls that were tipped. How does he not wind up?
Mason was not happy last week, and maybe he got froze out. Who knows?
I don't understand. The other thing is, too, here's a tip. Play T.O., matchup depending. I know we just said
matchups are garbage.
You know what? But he has a garbage day against the Eagles, and then all of a sudden goes out against the 80th string in the Houston Texans in a game he has no business being in, by the way.
I know.
Just to coddle Terrell Owens. Just base your decision on to see who they're playing that week. It might be a good idea.
I'm now 2-4.
I lost. You won.
I'm wrong. What's your record?
3-3.
Well, you better look out. Do you hear those footsteps?
You're in my division.
Could be me.
I'm unbeaten in our division.
Thanks for listening, everybody. We'll see you next week.
See ya.
All right, guys. Matchups or just best players? And I guess it depends. If you've got two good players at a position, then you have to think matchups. Otherwise, just play your best guys week in and week out.
I don't know about playing T.O. matchup dependent. I think I'd start little T.O. as my number three every week. But seriously, yeah, I mean, I'll play the stud normally, but like you said, if you have a decision, it's about the matchups. You know, I mean, Larry Johnson this week is a good example. Go with what's working and avoid with what is not working. Right now, it's not really working, so I'm going to look for another option. I may sit Larry Johnson this week.
Right. Agreed.
So I'm a little bit. I my studs stay. Larry Johnson, they stay. You know, it hurts worse if you sit one of those guys and they go off. And they're capable of going off. They don't have the reputations of only going off against weak teams or whatever. Like, I had a matchup this week, Joe Horn or Rod Smith. Looked at the matchup, you go with Joe Horn, and sure enough, it worked out. Lesser guys, look at the matchup.
What if you have Larry Johnson this week against the Steelers or Deshaun Foster, who's running hard, running well, team's doing well. Great matchup.
Foster.
Go Foster.
Yeah, absolutely. Huh. All right, guys, let's move on here. It is email time. We love hearing from you. And this week, our first email is from Paul in Ardmore, who asks, who do I start this week? Reggie Wayne versus Washington or Keyshawn Johnson at Cincinnati? Eagles outside linebacker and our fantasy guru, Sean Barber, has the answer.
Usually I'm very very heavy favorite of starting any of the Colts wide receivers. Going back with a quarterback like Peyton Manning, it's vital to have a top-tier quarterback thrown to your wide receiver. And week in and week out, Peyton Manning and the Colts always try to attack you with their passing game. And then on the other hand, you look at Carolina Panthers. They have an outstanding wide receiver in Keyshawn Johnson, who is the number two wide receiver opposite of Steve Smith. though they don't have a top-tier quarterback, they have a more potent ground game with Deshaun Foster. So if I was you, I would stick with Reggie Wayne as your number one wide receiver this week in fantasy football.
I call him Guru only because he's little Guru. You're the big Guru. Bob, I want to ask you, Reggie Wayne, Keyshawn Johnson, both of them
Reggie
number
Wayne.
Two.
Sean hit it right at the beginning. And Indianapolis Colts wide receivers, you got to love them.
All right, next email question here. Michael from Scranton, PA. Would you consider trading Antonio Gates for Greg Jennings? Guru, big Guru, ooh. I want to know. This is a tough one.
This is a toughie. I would consider it if I really needed a wide receiver. I mean, quite frankly, Gates is clearly coming on with Phillip Rivers. He was a guy to trade for 2 weeks ago. I like Greg Jennings, though. I think he's for real. I think he's going to be the rookie of the year.
If you need a wide receiver, Jennings is your guy there. You better have another decent tight end, however, because let's face it, they don't get much better than Antonio Gates. Of course, our email bag. We love hearing from you. We're going to hear more from you later in the show. It is CSN Fantasy Fix at Comcast.net. We're coming right back in a moment with the Z-Man, but first check out the rest of the NFL matchups.
You're not the same person I met online. What happened to the happy boy in the yearbook picture?
I told myself I would not leave this date crying.
Did you know chickens are the only thing that don't have nasal passages? Let's talk about something fun. How about magic?
Tired of bad dates? Maybe it's time to try eHarmony. At eHarmony, we only match you with other singles who have been pre-screened for compatibility with you. So when you get to the first date, you know you have so much in common. Log on today and get your free personality profile.
Maybe you want a sedan designed for the driver. Or one that's also beautiful on the inside. Or one that can outrun the price of gas. There's a way to have all three. Introducing the 2007 Saturn Aura midsize sedan. Lease a new 2007 Saturn Aura XE for around $257 a month. Residency restrictions apply. Call for...
Why do you guys always get so many boxes?
All right, everyone, let's get started. Anyone seen Shuler?
Where's Shuler? Anybody seen Shuler?
Is the cost of getting there getting in the way of doing business? AirTran Airways offers low fares to 50 cities.
To be in the Cadillac model you want to be in. Right now, during the Cadillac Navigation event, if you buy or lease a specially equipped Cadillac, we'll throw in a navigation system to go along for the ride.
Visit your Chicagoland area Cadillac dealer.
All right, welcome back to Fantasy Fix. One more segment to go here. And as always, we bring in Rob Zarzycki, professional poker player, professional fantasy football player, international man about town.
Wow.
Not only that, you're leading our league, my friend. We've got our little friendly competition here. It's really not so friendly. There's a lot of fistfights after the show each week about this. But let's quickly go through the rules here. Running backs, wide receivers, tight ends, getting a point for every 20 yards, 6 points for the score. Quarterbacks, 1 point for 50, 4 points for a touchdown pass. And, of course, you cannot pick the same player twice. We look back at week six and, oh, my, who had a big week? I did. I went from last place to second. Of course, Rob, just steady, 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 leading the way with 200 points. So, well, Ed Barkowitz is out this week. So, Bob Cooney, do him a favor. Get him out of the cellar this week, would you please?
He's getting kind of heavy.
Who do you like?
Well, I really like the Eagles this week. I just think that they're going to put up a lot of points. Last week it didn't sit well in Eagle land. Defensively, they're struggling. I think when a team is struggling on defense, the fixes, I don't know if they can be made right away. Offensively, they're just going to look to outscore. And I think this is a week that they're going to do it. I think Donovan's going to go out for a lot of points. I think a lot of dinking and dunking to Westbrook. They didn't run a lot of screens last week, which they usually do. So I think that tandem will score high there. Steve Smith, I mean, Eddie hasn't used him all year. I mean, that's an obvious there. And then Randy McMichael's had two great weeks, and Harrington is really starting to like him. So his numbers are going up.
Ride the hot hand there. John, you're up, and you start with Byron Leftwich.
Other than the frightening resemblance to Gary Coleman, there is a lot to like about Byron Leftwich this week against those Houston Texans. Now, Matty Jones probably not going to play, but Reggie Williams is coming up big time, and I like Ernest Wolford as well. The only problem in this game is will they run all day with a big lead? However, I think Houston will give him a game at home. Deshaun Foster running very well outside the tackles. Very tough runner. D'Angelo Williams down for the count. So great matchup against Cincinnati. Roy Williams, what else can you say? I think a lot of points will be scored in that Lion-Jet game. He is a beast. And Chris Cooley, he's going to have to be the man this week because I think they're going to, again, take Portis out of the game. Brunell's going to have to wing it.
All right. And I'm going to try to back up my big week with another one. Jake DeLome is my quarterback simply because he's throwing to Steve Smith, and that gives you a chance for a big play each and every week. I think the Atlanta Falcons have the most overrated player in the NFL in Michael Vick and the most underrated in Warrick Dunn. I do not agree with Bob. I think even though it is the Steelers' defense, I think Warrick Dunn is a money player. I like him this week. Marvin Harrison, enough said there. Jason Witten, because I don't believe the Giants linebackers and strong safety can cover anybody, so Jason Witten should be wide open there. Now to the man who leads the way, Rob Zarzycki. Take it away, my friend.
Well, this week it's all about me. M.E., matchup exploitation.
Wow.
Chad Pennington going against the Detroit defense that's just given up touchdowns left and right. They've given up 13. That's leading the league in the NFL. He's also playing the best football I've seen him play. He's coming off a 2-touchdown, 0-interception performance last week. Kevin Jones, on the flip side, he's going against the Jets, who cannot play defense against the pass or the run. We all remember last week, Ronnie Brown finally broke 100 yards. Kevin Jones last week finally broke 100 yards. And also a touchdown. Reggie Williams coming off that bye week. I'm with John. Leftwich should have a huge week. Matt Jones has been a little bit hobbled. If he is not back at full health, look for Reggie Williams to remain a main primary focus on that offense. Last week, T.O. got 3 touchdowns. Against that Houston defense. L.J. Smith from Rutgers University. Touchdown last week against the Saints. And the Bucks, who L.J. Smith will be going against, a little bit weak defending against the tight end. We've seen big games out of Ernie Conwell and Todd Heap.
All right. Well, you know, we also have a knockout pool here, and this is really kind of amazing because going into week 7, we're all still alive. John and I liked the Broncos last week, and Ed and Rob rode the Cowboys to victory. So going into this week, Carolina is my team. This is my chance to win it all. All I need is Houston pull
I'll
off the upset
I'm
of the Jaguars.
I am worried. I am very worried.
That is going to be my ticket. Come on, Texans.
You may win it.
All right, we are running out of time. We want to get to some more emails. And first one comes from Eric in Philadelphia, and he says, would you trade Reggie Wayne to get Matt Hasselbeck? Rob, I'll start with you. Reggie Wayne for Matt Hasselbeck.
Well, yes and no. It depends on your needs.
Thank you for your decisiveness. No, I'm kidding.
It depends on your needs. If you need a receiver and you have depth at quarterback, then yes, go ahead and make the trade. Same thing with quarterback. If you need a quarterback and you're deep on receiver, then go for the quarterback.
All right. Mike G. in South Philadelphia writes, would you pick up Driver or Edwards? I'm going to open that one. Both of them are available in his league, so I'm just going to open that up for anybody.
Was that a me, myself, and I league?
I guess. So you've got Donald Driver.
Well, you got to go Driver.
Yeah.
I mean, Braylon Edwards, I love Braylon Edwards. He is definitely a future star, but he's a little hit or miss.
It's just the quarterback situation there, too. Matt from Honeybrook, PA, asks, are you concerned about Grossman after that disaster on Monday night? Again,
yes.
I open it up. Yes, we are concerned, and the question is why.
Yeah, because I think that the other weeks were more of an aberration than what happened this week. And he's just going to be a middle of the roader for the next rest of the year.
I'm not so concerned. You got to give him a little more credit because he has put it on for so many weeks early on. And that's just one bad week. I think he'll turn it
Turn it back.
I also agree with you. I think that everyone throws in a clunker once in a while. I want to get to this question. Greg from Pottstown, PA, he is 5-1. Now, he has a bunch of guys on bye this week. He may have to drop a player in order to have a starter at every position this week. Therefore, his question is, would you risk releasing a guy just to earn the win? John, let's start with you. That's a tough one.
I don't think so. I have the Bears, and if you have the Bears and you need to drop the Bears, you'll take a zero and you'll like it, okay? Because when you have a great player, a point producer, you know what? 1 week is 1 week. You still may win. Imagine if you would have won if you didn't drop the guy, and I think it's a risky move dropping
quickly.
This comes with if you get penalized for playing a guy with bye, and we're in a league where you do get penalized for that. So if not, and I think that's a great rule to get penalized.
Just have a yes or no quickly. Quick, or one answer.
I think it reverts to depth. If you got the depth, you can let him go.
Okay.